Are you dealing with a personal injury? Don't go it alone. Turn to the experienced team at Phillips Law Firm. Their attorneys have helped thousands of clients get the compensation they deserve. Call Phillips Law Firm now. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
They called him the most powerful man in Hollywood, and he really was for decades.
He extended his tentacles like an octopus throughout the entire entertainment industry.
Mr. Lou Wasserman.
This is Glitter and Might, an Odyssey Originals documentary podcast series written and narrated by me, Sean Levy. All episodes are available on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ted Smith. Thanks for listening to the Men's Room Daily Podcast. Want more? Check out the greatest podcast in all the land, The Podcast. Be sure to subscribe and listen to a brand new episode every Tuesday night.
Unfortunately, what you're about to hear is real. The members of this radio program are simply not that bright, or what some people would call educated. They are merely stupid. They're not trying to offend anyone on purpose. And all have played doctors on TV. You have been warned and are cordially invited to join the party. This is the Men's Room.
Forget it, man, and get with the countdown. Get with the countdown. Shake this square world and blast off for Kicksville. The trippers, the grasshoppers, the hip ones, all gathered in secrecy and flying high as a kite.
This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. You know what they say, shake your radio more than three times, and you're playing with it. You're listening to the Men's Room.
And away we go. Welcome to Season 18, episode number 3,908. Along with Steve the Throw Hill, the Ted Smith, and Michael.
Good week.
Good summary.
Thank you. Hardman Drill. Care of myself. On tap today, it is a random question. Your guess is as good as mine. Categories, Ubers, and money. We will play Profile This. Plus headlines, a Men's Room shout of the day, fundable listener emails, and everyone's favorites. TV time with Ted.
Click, click.
Drink it, they drunk. All right, here we go. Florida man breaks into Busch Gardens in Tampa just to jump into the alligator pit. Meanwhile, telling someone that you went to jail because you shot a mouse, that would be kind of tough to admit. Christmas tree is still up in a town because a pigeon made it their home. To Indonesia, where the naked Australian surfers do roam. And a stone Florida driver busted racing another with his two small children in tow and a whole bunch of weed. That is all coming on today's very special episode of The Men's Room.
And now, here's the question.
Hola, bitches. Good day to you and yours. All right, the 1980s were the heyday of goofy but enjoyable action movies. And leading the way as action heroes were Sylvester Stallone and Arnold Schwarzenegger. Well, I did not know this, even though they're friends now. Back in the day, apparently they hated each other because they had a rivalry about who's going to be the bigger action star. But in a recent interview, Sylvester Stallone admitted that Arnold Schwarzenegger was, quote, the superior action star. But keep in mind, they were acting. Now, in South Korea, a man was not acting when he became his own action star. This dude started scaling the world's fifth tallest building. The building is 123 stories tall, and he managed to climb to the 72nd story, over 1,000 feet in the air, using only his bare hands. But it should be noted that 5 years ago, a different climber made it to the 75th story of the same building, and amazingly, neither of these guys needed to be rescued, but at least to be a cool rescue story. The same cannot be said for three men in England. They needed rescue last week after their watercraft drifted out to sea. What makes it embarrassing was that their watercraft was a giant inflatable duck. Even worse, they were rescued by a single dude on a paddleboard. I mean, it's just not a good look, right? That's embarrassing. Now, these are just some of the stories we've come across. Stories that left us with many questions. Questions we'd like to ask you in the form of a random question, and this is how it works. You call us, we ask you a question at complete random. And after you share your story, we will share with you the news story that inspired said question.
Be part of the big show, the random question. Call 206-803-ROCK. Like the Men's Room on Facebook, follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Men's Room Live, and send your emails to themensroom@kisw.com.
So, I just got the State Farm Personal Price Plan on my car insurance.
So you told your agent you play the bagpipes for your dog?
What? No, I didn't get that personal. My agent just helped me create an affordable price just for me. Okay, let me show you what I've been working on. Hey, Buster!
Call State Farm agent Sierra Belleville in Bellingham today.
Prices vary by state. Options selected by customer. Availability and eligibility may vary.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9. KISW.
Oh, but tell us, away we go. Welcome to season 18, episode number 3908. What a large and in charge program we have for you today. Guaranteed future repeat.
Oh, yeah.
It's a fact. Exciting return of your guests is as good as mine. We've got some good categories today. We have what they say are the 10 best states in the United States as far as pulling their weight for the United States economy.
Ah, okay.
So you're talking about
the economic power.
Yeah, the states that that bring the money home for the rest of the country. They got them ranked from 1 to 50. You wouldn't be shocked the ones at the bottom, but you might be surprised some of the ones at the top.
Okay.
So they base that on exports and startup activity of new companies, economic wealth, unemployment rates, household incomes, shares of the local population in poverty, innovation potential. Factors such as the share of high-tech jobs and entrepreneurial activity. West Virginia's last.
Dead last.
I know you're going to pick that. Just know, if you're wondering where all the money's coming from that you enjoy in this wonderful country we live in, not West Virginia.
It's not West Virginia.
Not okay. West Virginia. Then we have for you, and this is from the fine folks at Uber, the top 10 most common things that people forget.
Okay.
And they're taking an Uber ride. So those are the two categories coming up with your guess is as good as mine. And as we do every Monday through Friday, we'll head on over exclusively to the Odyssey app for the Men's Room Happy Hour and episode number 402. Give some props and some love from the weekend. Keep in mind, anytime you listen to KISW and you listen through the app or you listen to the Men's Room, do yourself a favor. Sign in every single time you do that.
Correct.
Because every hour you listen, you have a chance for entry on a pair of tickets. This week, the show is Ghost at White River Amphitheater.
All right. When are they coming to town?
They're coming on August the 4th. Not only will you win tickets to the show, they are having like a pre-show experience that includes a VIP bar, free snacks, ghost memorabilia, all kinds of stuff like that. So not only are you getting the
tickets. You should never expect them to show up, though. The name of the band's Ghost. So, like, if they don't show up at an event they're supposed to be at, like, you got ghosted. You go, like, right.
Well, they're
right there in the name.
What if they're there and you can't see them because they're ghosts?
Oh, that's a good point.
See, that's what I would say if I was the manager. Like,
oh, they're here.
They're here amongst us.
Right.
When they're back, when they're passed out on the bus, whatever the deal is.
Oh, they're here.
No, they're here amongst us. They're ghosts.
You see?
Wait, do you expect to see a ghost? Who sees a ghost?
Yeah, come on.
People who are nuts see ghosts. Man, you're just here for the food and drinks. Come on, man. Let's see the show.
They're here. They're watching.
That's what I'd say. This is a meet and greet. Just put your hand out and shake it.
They're shaking it. I promise it.
Yeah, exactly. You know what happens when you sleep with your mouth open? Yep. They're coming to see you, too. So tickets to Ghost when you want, when you sign up and log into the Odyssey app. So every hour that you listen, you have a different entry into the contest to win that. Also, don't forget that all our podcasts are there. Listen to a lot of the Men's Room radio station over the weekend. Enjoyed that thoroughly. And my car rides, man, I figured out how to work my Bluetooth a little bit better. I know that sounds like something that any five-year-old can do, and yes, they can.
Five-year-olds can, yes.
I figured out how to kind of do it. So I was listening to the Men's Room radio. A lot of country on there, a lot of rap on there, a lot of disco on there, a lot of rock. It's just a hodgepodge of everything. Honest to God, I drove an hour to Tacoma, put that thing on, man. I was like, this is awesome.
It is. It's good stuff, so mostly.
Get a chance to check out. They let us basically put together our own music channel.
Mm-hmm.
So we all got so far 50 songs apiece in there. So so check that out if you get a chance. If you miss any of the podcasts, Ted's podcast, The Podcast, Megacast, Greatest Story Never Told podcast, so many damn podcasts on there, I can't keep up. We have the Weekly Best Stuff podcast, The Daily Podcast. It's all on one place. That is the Men's Room page on the Odyssey app. So check that out. And what else do we have for you today? Oh, today is the day that we do our random question, 206-803-ROCK.
Random, random.
Hello,
random,
Catherine. Random, welcome random, to the Men's Room. Random.
Hola, gentlemen.
Hola.
Catherine, welcome to the program. And the random question. Oh, Catherine, you've been married for a while?
With the same partner for a while. Not married yet.
How long you been with this guy, dude?
10 years.
10 years?
Okay.
Five years.
Is it even worth proposing at this point, or is it just like, look, we're good? Obviously, we're together. It's been 5 years. Would you care if he proposed, or would it just be like, what are you doing?
We both see marriage the same way as just, okay, it would be nice for taxes. Neither of us see it like some people do.
Yeah, well, you know, health insurance goes a long way. Are you still there?
Yeah.
Okay. Here is your random question. As far as your attire and your wardrobe is concerned, if I walk in and open up your closet or your drawers, what color is the most predominant in your clothes, would you say?
Is it a fair answer to say multicolor? Because I really like things that are not necessarily rainbow, but have tons of color to them. I own so many things that are like at least three or four colors.
Okay, the multicolor, that does it. So if we opened your closet, it'd be like looking through a kaleidoscope, basically.
Pretty much.
Okay. Yeah. All right. That's different. Pants, too?
Oh, yeah. The most colorful pants you can find.
All right, because that's one thing. I've seen the shirts. I play. Sure. Pants are a little bit different as far as getting a little bit wacky.
You go out more on a limb if you have crazy pants on. Right. A shirt can be anything. Mm-hmm. Nobody cares.
And there's no patterns. It doesn't matter. A lot of pants. But, yeah. Okay.
What is your favorite color? If they said, look, you got to stop with the multicolored stuff. You have to pick one color to wear for 1 month. What color are you going with?
Purple.
All right.
Purple. Okay.
I'm just assuming you're a Ravens fan. I know that's not true, but I'm going to pretend that you are.
My uncle and dad make fun of me all the time because probably 90% of my clothing is black.
Yeah, black or gray.
So every time I come down there, they live in Florida. Now, Florida is the most ridiculously dressed state in the United States. As far as you want to get loud and obnoxious with T-shirts, hats, shorts.
Doesn't matter, yeah.
No one cares, right? So they always say, like, you're going to get your colored clothing coming there from Sadville.
Nope.
Sadville. So my uncle always buy me like a bright green shirt or something. Like, I can't wear this.
Well, like, look, man, we get a lot of free T-shirts just by the nature of working at a rock station. 99% of bands are going to give you a black T-shirt.
Mm-hmm. Almost all of my shorts are black. My socks are black. Most of my shoes are black or white. I have a very boring wardrobe.
I got mostly black and gray, but I like my crazy ass paisley stuff too. So that,
yeah, you blend. You just
that's where I rock and roll a little bit.
Throw
man.
It in with a black. It all blends with a black. Yeah. If you know what I'm saying. Well, the reason we ask what color is most of your clothes, they say if you're going out on a first date, you probably should not wear your Cleveland Brownies jersey, not because they suck, but because of the color.
And also they suck.
Yeah. There's a new report.
They say
out.
Don't wear brown on a first date.
Oh yeah, new report out on the worst colors to wear on a first date, according to relationship experts. Here are the ones they say you should avoid. Number one, brown. Brown can make you appear unadventurous, conservative, and unwilling to take risks. It's also associated with kind of an earthiness and can make
and
you
poop.
Appear too casual or relaxed. The worst is a flat, darker shade of brown. Now, lighter and richer hues, they say, can work. But if you're just
so brown, that's the ultimate. Well, what would you think? You go out on a date, right, and she shows up and she's wearing a brown dress. Do you care?
I don't care personally, but at the same time.
You would notice.
Maybe I would notice that dress. Do you remember the last time I wore this? Yeah, our first date, because I thought, who the hell would wear a brown dress?
Yeah, you know what? That's the one time I would remember. Yes, I do remember that dress, baby. Yeah.
Other than that.
It does not make your butt look big, but you look like a turd.
And I always think it's going to be something like where we just had crazy sex or something. Do you remember the last time I wore this? It's a summery dress. My cousin's wedding. No, your aunt's wedding.
Sorry, my bad.
So brown, they say, is terrible. And by the way, even if you show up at a wedding in a brown suit, you still don't look good.
A brown suit, man.
Because I remember back in like the 70s, 80s, people wear brown suits, like blue shirts.
But even then, they look stupid. Like, I know it was kind of the fashion thing, but you still knew then, like, that's a terrible look. Right.
Gray, they say, is number two. Gray makes you appear unapproachable. It might come off as too neutral or even indifferent, like you're not particularly excited or enthusiastic to be there. I'll just put some gray on.
I'm sorry, we're gray.
Well, yeah, I mean,
just to let people know, I'm unapproachable too.
Here we just wear it to blend.
Right.
Number three, bright colors. They say you don't want to go too bold. Bright colors can make you appear too flashy or like you're trying too hard, but they can also be a distraction. Number four on the worst colors to wear on a first date, that would be yellow. Yellow, apparently, and I know this now, is the color of friendship and caution. That's why I got in trouble for sending the yellow roses.
Okay, well, look, if you're a florist, and I mean this from the bottom of my heart, we're dudes, so we got to buy flowers from time to time, right? You need a chart that says what the different colored roses mean, because we don't know. Because like you said, you bought yellow roses because you thought like, oh, that's different.
Well, I went to the forest and they looked nice. They were like the nicest ones there.
That's what I'm saying.
They hadn't really opened all the way. They looked, the color on them was better. The other roses just kind of looked kind of like...
But I thought the floors... Curmudgeon-y. The floors should at least say to you like, okay, sir, look, I have no problem selling you these. Who are these for? You say, mm-hmm. They're my wife. Like, do not get these yellow roses. You must get red.
Yeah.
Period.
So if yellow means friendship or caution, you want to avoid those if you're trying to make a love connection. Number five on the worst colors to wear.
But that's weird. Thing. A lot of condoms are yellow.
Well, they are.
I mean, they are. Yeah. Right? I mean, seriously, well, man. Like, a lot of condoms are bright colored. A lot of them are yellow. And it's like, oh, my God, you're very cautious. Well, yeah, it's safe well, sex.
That's the Big Bird collection. You got to get into the Grimace collection from McDonald's
the
now.
The Big Bird collection of condoms.
It's Grimace's birthday, so go purple. Look at this thing. It was purple to begin with, and now it's more purple.
Now it looks like Grimace.
Now it's deep purple. Let's go space trucking.
If you put on a condom and a woman says, your penis reminds me of Grimace, that's not a compliment.
Or Barney.
Oh, God. Yeah. I don't know if that's the last word she says right before I'm about to hop in the putter sock, as it were, and she says, you know, man, you remind me of Barney. I'm like, I can't do this.
Well, if you put on Prince, like Dirty Mind, and then put on a purple condom, would you think you're weird?
Yes.
Okay.
But I wouldn't care.
I shouldn't have done that.
Be a little low for a second. Wait, what?
Right. Too much black, they say. Black is generally a good choice.
So I don't go naked.
But don't look too goth. Wearing all black may make you come across as a little bit morbid. So, guess what? What color should you wear after all of this survey that they did? What would you say is the best color to wear on a first date?
I never put that much thought into it. You're just hoping to get laid, right? Mm-hmm. The best color to wear.
Best color to wear.
Blue.
They didn't say.
Oh, come on.
Other than just wear something that makes you feel confident.
Well, what if wearing gray makes you feel confident?
Yeah, exactly.
What if wearing brown, wearing all brown should not make you feel confident? But if it does, no. Right?
I'm no kidding. The thing I feel the worst about of the Cleveland Browns, not the fact that they have never won a Super Bowl, because they have not. But Ted would argue this point. He likes a very plain, basic uniform. So, like, Penn State, he thinks is one of the best uniforms.
The Colts, right.
And you know what? He likes Alabama's basic design. I think it's a little boring, to be honest with you.
Sure, sure.
But in the same vein, there's nothing uglier than the Cleveland Browns uniform.
There's not.
And so if you're a fan of that team, you want to rock your fandom. You know, you want a jersey.
But you never look good in it.
What is your logo? They came out with a logo today. A brand new logo. I don't know if they're going to stick it on their helmet or.
They're putting it on the helmet. I think they just put it on the field. So they'll put it at the 50-yard line, but they still won't put anything in that ugly-ass orange helmet. And when the Cleveland Browns were moving to Baltimore back in the mid-90s, whatever, mm-hmm. I remember the one thing that Cleveland said was, hey, you know, we're pissed that we're losing our team, but you can't have our name or our color. And everyone in Baltimore was like, brother, nobody wants to name their team the Browns who wear brown.
Oh, that was,
and are you kidding me?
That was one of the stipulations. We want to stay the Cleveland Browns.
Please do.
And everybody's like, I mean, because, you know, even Modell at the time knew, like, I can't even sell any of this crap. Like, it's a collective bargaining agreement, but we're not selling crap. I mean, to anybody.
It's ugly.
Anybody.
Random. Hello, Marquez. Random, welcome to the men's room. Random.
Uh-oh.
Hola.
Hello.
Marquez.
Nope.
Put it back on hold. Hang on. Hello, Taylor. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, guys. What's going on?
Hola.
Taylor, how are you? Welcome to the random question.
I'm doing pretty killer.
Okay, let's go to this one. What would you say is the loudest concert or event that you've experienced? And here in this town, you could be just going to a Seahawk game.
Yeah, no kidding.
But what's the loudest show?
Man.
Could have been a club show.
So I'm a metalhead. I want to say, honestly, really tough.
It is tough. AC/DC comes to mind.
I definitely remember Ministry being one of the louder shows I went to.
I can believe that. They're just a loud band in general.
There's this band called Norma Jean. They're like...
Yeah.
You've heard of them. They played at, El Corazon.
Oh, yeah.
Like, years ago, and it was... Like, I've been in pits before, and this was when I was still in, like, my mosh pit days.
Sure.
I went in, and this song came on, and I knew the song, and I was super excited. And when, like, they do this giant build-up to this breakdown, and I remember it got so loud that I forgot that I was in the middle of the pit, and when I tell you I got the S kicked out of me, oh, man.
It was that loud in there.
Again, I got disoriented. It was like, oh, I know this song. Oh, it's crazy. And then all of a sudden I looked around and I'm like dead center, you know, where everyone like clashes and you got those people that do the kick things and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, this dude lit me up. He had to have been a linebacker for like a JUCO college or something. He hit me so hard. But I mean, you know, your first couple shows, it's awesome. You're like, oh, I just got, you know, wrecked. I'm cool.
Yeah, then you get to the age where you're like, at what age did you end your mosh pitting ways?
I went to, I think it was Deftones at WAMU Theater. And I was like, oh, you know, I'm drunk enough. I think this will be a good idea. This was like 2 years ago. I'm 34 now. I went home and like ice on both shoulders, my ankle all of a sudden started hurting. I was done.
Yeah. I mean, that's all. Yeah. I cannot remember the show I was at. I don't remember who was playing. But it's years ago. I was back in Baltimore, but I didn't know that a mosh pit was going to happen. All right. So whoever the opening band was, I'd wiggle my way up toward the front of the stage with a couple of buddies. Well, the second band comes on. God, I wish I could remember. But I mean, the place instantly turns into a mosh pit, all right? So I'm trying to get out of this mosh pit, which is no easy feat. These people are just losing their minds. I finally get to the edge, but as I'm like exiting the mosh pit, I get hit, so I kind of bounce into the bouncer. So he looks down, but instead of getting angry, dude picks me up and throws me back in the mosh pit.
Here you go, kid.
Yeah, he thought. I'm like, oh, no, man. I mean, seriously, just picked my ass up, threw me right back in. I'm like, you've got to be kidding me. So I had to get out of the mosh pit again, but I made it a point to go to the other side.
Yeah. Raise my ass, what was the loudest event or concert that you've experienced? Metallica. They performed over at a UK festival, and on Thursday night, their 16-song set was so loud that people complained from 15 miles away.
15 miles.
Nearby cities reported noise complaints to the police, thinking the booming sounds were coming from their neighbors. Strong winds and a new sound system, they may have been to blame, especially since it was announced beforehand that Metallica would be using 288 staggered speakers to immerse the entire audience. So it's coming from all sides.
15 miles?
288 staggered speakers.
Jesus,
at this festival. Complaints from 15 miles away.
And somebody just chimed in the text line. Says, loudest show I ever saw, Cannibal Corpse. Also at El Corazon.
More of the random question coming up. 206-803-ROCK.
Disney's Little Mermaid makes a big splash returning to the Fifth Avenue Theater this fall. Ariel, King Triton, Flounder, Scuttle, Ursula, and Prince Eric tell the story of dreams, love, family, and friendship that has delighted generations. Dive under the sea with Ariel and her friends as they sing some of the best-known songs of the last century, playing September 8th through October 8th. Accessible performances are available. Get your tickets today at fifthavenue.org.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
Right, a question, 206-803-ROCK.
A lot of people chiming in on the last question there. What's the loudest concert they've been to? So one guy corrected himself. It was at El Corazon. However, the band was Insane Clown Posse. Super loud. Loudest concert, Pantera at the Gorge. And they say, yes, it was an outdoor venue, but my ears rang for 2 days after that. Loudest concert I've seen The Who several times. They're known for being loud. AC/DC also loud, but the loudest, Ted Nugent at the Paramount. My ears are ringing for days.
Okay.
Somebody else says, I had 10th row to see Judas Priest on the Ram It Down tour back in 88. I was so miserable that my friend and I went to the far back to watch.
Wow.
And someone else, let's see. Hey, guys, loudest concert I ever saw. It's one of those festivals, a bunch of band. A Tribe Called Quest came on, said it was super loud, and Metallica, at Lumen. They said it was so loud you couldn't hear the words, just guitars and drums. Apparently the UK does pretty well. So there's a band, a punk group called The Gallows. In England, they hit 132 decibels. That was the fifth loudest. KISS in Canada in 2009, 136 decibels. Band called Left Field, they played in England, 137 decibels. Everyone's favorite band, Man of War. This was in 2008. If you're familiar with Man of War, they were around in like
88.
Yeah, they're around in the 80s. Silly band. Anyway, 139 decibels, but the loudest, I've never heard of this band, but they're called Sleazy Joe. They played in Sweden. 143 decibels.
Not ugly kid.
Not ugly kid Joe.
Sleazy Joe.
This is Sleazy Joe.
Different Joes.
Yes, different Joes. Hello, Brian. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, I'm here.
Hola.
Brian, welcome to the program. Hola. Random question, question.
Hola to you, Brian.
All right, let's see here. Other than being in a plane, since your time on this earth, where do you think is the highest location that you have ever been? So Steve lived in the Denver area. Right. Away, you're mile high.
You're mile high, but we went to Mexico City, which is even a higher elevation. But you climbed to the top of
the Strat now in Vegas. Used to be a stratosphere, and they had that parachute drop thing, and that was, I think, 1,100 feet.
Damn.
Roughly.
Did you actually do the parachute drop?
This is the old one, not the one that you bungee off of, but right on the very top, you got to go to the top floor, then there's another, I don't know, 10 floors, and you're on the roof, and it would just shoot you straight up.
Have you ever done any local hiking, like done Mount Si or Tiger Mountain or any of those?
No.
Okay, all right. Well, I'm just saying, 4,000 feet sometimes.
I've been hiking, but...
Not trying to do the mountains.
Yeah, and I've never been up Rainier or Mount St. Helens. If I was to do St. Helens, it'd probably been the time it blew.
All right. Perfect timing.
Well, like,
how high up did you get on? Because you guys didn't reach the summit of Mount Rainier.
No, we got a little bit up past...
how many feet up did you get? You and
probably,
A.E.
Probably,
Dave.
Probably 9,000 to 10,000 feet. So just a little bit beyond Camp Muir.
Okay.
But then I don't know if that is, I don't know. I was at the top of the Columbia Tower on the fireman stair thing with Castle. I'm not sure if that's higher.
What do you mean?
Elevation-wise, compared to, I don't think it's 10,000 feet.
No, it's definitely not 10,000
feet. But I mean, it's like, as far as me being in a high spot where I could tell.
See,
I was in a high spot.
That's different. When you're in a building, and like Toronto CN Tower, right? Like, we went to the top, and like I said, they had a glass floor, and I looked straight down, which I kind of wish I had not have done. And, like, I understand that I have been higher than where I'm standing, but, you know, on a mountain, it's still ground below your feet. When I looked at that glass floor, I'm like, okay, I feel that I'm high up in the air, and you get that weird feeling in your knees. I don't know.
Chicago Tower is supposedly a doozy if you get to the top of that
one. It's now with the Willis Tower, I guess. I did that in 94. The thing that was crazy about that to me was they've changed a little bit since I've been there. Because you couldn't go outside. You know, like the Empire State Building, you walk outside. But the buildings in New York are so tall, you don't necessarily feel super high up. But we went to the Willis Tower, and it turns out in 94, Chicago was hosting the World Cup. So for the first time in my life, and it was just such a weird thing, we get to the top, looking out the window, I'm like, all right, this is cool. Then I realized there are all these blimps flying around, right, for coverage of the World Cup, but we were above them. And I had never seen the top of a blimp. It was just kind of a weird, weird feeling.
Well, the reason we asked, what's the highest you've been and where? A British man was detained after climbing more than halfway up the world's fifth tallest skyscraper with only his bare hands. He did it this morning in Seoul. More than 90 police and other emergency personnel, they were dispatched to the 123-story, 1,820-foot tall Lotte World Tower.
Huh.
After the man was spotted scaling the building this morning, the man in his 20s reached the 72nd floor free climbing, which is about 1,000 feet high, before officials took him to a gondola lift and moved him inside the building. Reports said he was carrying a parachute and told police he wanted a base jump from the top of the building. He was arrested in 2019 after scaling the Shard in London. That's the UK's tallest skyscraper at 1,000 feet. After the owners of the buildings pressed charges against him for trespassing, he was sentenced to 6 months in prison and served three. In 2021, he climbed the 36-story Stratosphere Tower, the residential block of London's Stratford neighborhood. Reached the top in less than a half an hour. He said he picked the building because he was shocked by the flash floods that recently hit the area, and he wanted to raise awareness about the seriousness of climate change.
How does that make sense?
I don't know. The Lotte property, which operates the tower, said the man did not suffer any major injuries. The fire agency statement said he suffered a cut on his skin on his right knee. Other than that, no injuries. They do note that in 2018, French climber Alain Robert, known as Spider-Man for his daring stunts, was also detained after he climbed to the 75th floor of the Lotte World Tower. We have a Lotte hotel across
the
street.
We do. So I would not scale it.
I'm assuming
it's... I know you don't like heights. Would you do a rock wall?
I have done a rock wall.
Have you? Okay. My daughter went to one yesterday, and I'm looking at the video.
You mean a climbing wall?
Like climbing wall.
I have not done a climbing wall.
All right. So she did a climbing wall, and I'm watching the video, and...
as I'm watching the video, she's doing great, right? You know, she's starting to trust herself. She's scaling all the way up. She gets pretty high. And then my wife says something to her, so she kind of turns around and looks down. And when she looked down, she started working her way back down.
Like, that's it.
Yeah, I mean, it's what they always say, don't look down, yeah. Right? Just don't do that. And anytime I see
she's got the right build for it. She's strong. She's tall.
She's tall. She's thin. And she was doing great until she looked down.
And you look at those pros that do that. That's what you need. You need a longer arm for a handhold or a foothold or whatever the deal is. And you need to be able to be strong enough to pull yourself, light enough to do it, and lanky enough to be able to make those reaches.
All right, now let me ask you this. So, say Bear Grylls. Say we get him in studio and he says, you know what, fellas, I like you. Why don't we do one of my episodes of Survive Bear Grylls, whatever the hell it's called, where he puts you through those challenges. A lot of times it's like rappelling down the side of a cliff. Would you do it? Bear, he personally invites you, says, Miles, I like you, man. You're cool. Let's do the TV show together. Now, I don't mind the eating weird stuff. I can get through that. But I don't know about the rappelling down the cliffs.
I mean,
he's personally invited you, Mike. Are you going?
Cliff is a stretch, but I have done it before, kind of.
You've rappelled?
Rappelled, yeah.
I've rappelled.
Rappelling's
fine because basically you're just looking at the rock wall in front of you. There's not a lot of need to look down if you don't want to.
But the problem with the rappelling is that you have to walk off the edge of this. I don't care how tall or short it is. It's still a cliffside when you're walking down and you need to rappel.
I think that's my initial thing is I have to step. It's like I said with bungee jumping. I understand how it's supposed to work, but I'm supposed to jump off of this bridge of my own volition, man. I don't think that's
happening. The one that we used to do in Boy Scouts in West Virginia had about a 5-foot lip ledge. So you kind of had to get out on that ledge, and then you had to jump and catch yourself and swing underneath. If you grab the rope too soon, you'd smack your head into the ledge. So it's like a curved ledge, and then the rest
of the
rope.
What are you supposed to do?
You're supposed to jump out and swing
before your hands are on the rope.
No, your hands are on the rope. You back yourself back up. And then all of a sudden you get 1, 2, 3, and you just got to pop up far enough to make sure that you can make the clearance on the lip of the cliff. That was the one part that freaked me out.
How high? Well, yeah. A
couple hundred feet.
For real?
Oh, yeah. That's how you get your
in Boy Scouts?
Oh, yeah.
Geez, I thought you said like 30 feet.
No, you're all roped up. I mean, there's
I understand fantastic. That, but still, man.
I mean, the harness is grabbing your boys. You're tight. You're in there pretty good. You feel secure with the rope.
Do you?
And you feel secure with
no,
the
No, you don't.
See, man.
You really don't, man. until you get on the actual face of the wall.
Yeah.
He's right in that when you finally do get your feet on the wall and you're just jumping, it's a lot easier because you're going in the right direction and you're going at your own speed, which is great.
That is a huge difference.
But I think it was like a church camp that I did one summer or something like that they had, you know, they brought us up there and we were rappelling down this cliffside. It was maybe 20, maybe 30 feet.
So it would suck if you fell. That's a different. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like, this will suck bad versus I'm going to die.
Correct. Yeah, it wasn't going to be lethal, but it's still not something that I wanted to have happen.
No.
And I did go up there, got hooked up, freaked out, came back down, knew that I wouldn't live with myself if I didn't do it. Went all the way back up there, got hooked back up, cried my ass all the way down, but I made it. Doggone it.
All right. Let's fight through the tears, Mike. Random. Hello, Spencer. Welcome to the men's room.
Aloha, bitch. Hola.
Hola.
Spencer, welcome to the program. Random question. All right, let's go this. When did you unexpectedly get laid? When did you unexpectedly get laid?
No, not like that. She just wouldn't like to hear this story. Well, a stripper took me home once.
All right.
I wasn't expecting that.
No, I would never expect that either.
So what, were you at the club throwing a mad cash at her, or did she just single you out and decide she liked you?
No, I was really young and, you know, just broken up with my girlfriend. She was older than me. And we ended up going back to my house. I was really drunk. And, yeah, it was pretty cool what I can remember.
Look, I know where I'm going. I know that I'm going with a group of friends. I know the reason we're going and everything else. The last thing that I would ever think is that I would go home with somebody from there.
Yeah.
And trust me, in Reno, man, you know, like, okay.
You went to a strip club in Reno?
I did, because they had sushi. So, all right. So this is, okay.
Wait, you went to the strip club in Reno because sushi so bad that you went to a strip club to get it?
No. We just found out it was the best sushi in town. We got there.
Is that what everyone said?
Everybody.
Really?
Everybody. So, it's normal to eat in a strip club in Reno. That is not a weird thing.
But the sushi.
It's like going to Dallas. You can get a steak, lobster.
Sure. But in Dallas, you know, like they have cows. So eating beef at a strip club does not bother me so much. But right. Sushi in Reno already sounds like a bad idea. Sushi at a strip club in Reno sounds like a worse idea. Was the sushi good?
We did not eat the sushi.
You don't?
I did not eat the sushi. We stepped in there. It was just weird.
You went there to get sushi.
It's right there. And then the strippers, it's kind of like going to
But
the
you didn't crop. Get sushi.
No.
Why not? No. It's the best sushi in Reno, apparently. You were looking for sushi.
It is, but you can still smell the fish. Whenever I can smell the fish, I don't want to eat sushi.
Oh, yeah. That's a good sign.
And I'm pretty sure it was from the sushi.
It's not our sushi.
Yeah. That was one of
That's not the sushi, sir.
Those,
it is no, fresh.
That was one of those instances where I sat down in a chair, and all of a sudden, someone comes up to me, and they're very nice. And they're like, do you want a lap dance or whatever? I'm like, you know what? No, I just sat down. I'm cool. I'm just going to drink my beer here for a minute and get a shot. I'm good, but I really appreciate it. Thank you. 2 minutes later, she's back. Now she's sitting beside me. Now it's like, now all the people that I want to talk to, I can't.
Because
she's holding court.
Right.
So now I'm just like, no, I'm okay. Like, no, I don't really want to do that. I don't want a private room. No, that's okay. Hey, thank you for the offer. That's great. Still won't leave. And I'm just like, and that's why I ended up leaving, because I'm like, there's no goddamn way. I can't even, I can't, like, I've got somebody like sticking to my arm the entire, everywhere I go.
Why does that happen to me? I got thrown out of a joint in Alaska. I wasn't thrown out. I was not allowed back in. That's more accurate. But I'm in, and this place holds like 400 people, man. And I guess I cannot remember the name of the place, but if you're in Anchorage, like, I guess everyone knows this place, right? So I'm in there. I'm just trying to get hammered. And I did a pretty good job of that. But this one dancer, you know, she would do her dance or whatever. And then, like I said, this is a pretty large place. But she kept singling me out. And same thing. You want a lap dance? Nah, man, that's cool. You know, thanks, whatever. I'm just here to drink. Watch the action. 10 minutes goes by. She's back. And she won't talk to anybody else. She keeps coming up to me. So again, hey, what do you think about that lap dance? I'm like, man, No. It's cool. Really. Honest to God, I'm just here to drink. And this place is open. Because it's like after hours at this point. She comes by a third time. But now I'm drunk and irritated, okay? So she comes rolling up. Hey, you still think about that lap dance? I was like, I've not been thinking about the lap dance. I don't know how many times I've got to tell you this, man. I don't want a lap dance. What's wrong with me? So I'm just like, I think you're ugly, all right? And the thing, I didn't. Not really, you know, but I just want to say something so she'd leave me alone.
Sure.
And she did. So then I go out to smoke. No big deal. I go to walk in, and the bouncer's hand is firmly on my chest. And he just kind of shakes his head like, I can't let you back in, man. I'm like, that. He's like, I don't know what you said to her. So I told her she's ugly because I wanted her to leave me alone. He's like, okay, well, she's upset. You can't come back in. I'm like, I just want a drink.
That's it.
And she wouldn't leave me alone.
No.
Like, what the F, man?
The reason we asked, when did you unexpectedly get laid? Here's a doozy. Carrying around a condom is usually a smart idea, but according to Trojan, the people who make them, some people tote protection even in the saddest of circumstances. Mm-hmm. Nearly 1 in 8 men, 35 and under, admit to have brought protection to a funeral just in case.
Just in case.
Found in an online survey of more than 2,000 adults between the ages of 18 and 35, about 1 in 4 millennials brought protection to their high school reunion.
Okay, I understand that. That makes sense.
That makes a lot more sense.
Which I hope Cindy's still hot.
That's not nearly as morbid of a scenario. Trojan State of Sex Survey reveals some encouraging statistics as well. 77% of adults 18 to 35 believe that men and women should be equally responsible when providing protection. 78% of men would rather be responsible for wearing condoms than make their partner feel pressured to have to take birth control.
Well, sure, if you're trying to get it done, you're like, hey, we got it settled.
And 52% of women would rather their partners wear condoms than them taking the pill.
Hide your ugly penis.
Well, I just want you to wear a condom because it's unsightly.
Is that Grimace?
Oh, God.
Right. Well, I just went to a family wedding, but it's a family wedding. I would never think to bring a condom to a family wedding. I mean, look, it's one thing. It's one
I
thing.
Would hope not,
it's one
man.
Thing it's a friend.
Jesus Christ. Yeah. Most people are like, ooh, family wedding.
I know, but you think.
Grab the box of condoms.
Well, half the time when you're going to a funeral, it's either going to be a friend or family member, right?
Yeah.
It's got to be one of the two. So the same thing with weddings. Could you imagine bringing a condom to a family wedding?
Never know, man.
You don't.
But even a funeral.
Because somebody, one of your relatives is going to bring a date that you might find attractive, but that doesn't mean you're going to hit on that person.
Well, if I have the condoms, I will.
They're with somebody. So
I'm feeling more confident about hitting on you because I brought condoms.
What single random friend is just going to show up at a family wedding?
Sure.
I'm sure it happens.
I'm sure it happens, but I feel it's more... I don't know, man. Would you, all right.
What is weird?
Family funeral or the family wedding?
What is weirder to bring
a condom? Where do you think you have a better shot?
I think you have a better shot at the funeral.
Really?
Yes.
Oh, I'm going wedding all day.
No way. Wedding is invitation only. These are your family members. Anybody who's coming is going to be accompanied with someone. So even if you have a cousin that's got a hot girlfriend, it's with your cousin. She's with your cousin.
Well, how close is the cousin? What if it's like a fourth cousin?
Now. Well, no. Seriously, because you don't need to do that math.
What? No, I'm saying if you're a first cousin, obviously not. Second cousin, no.
Well, besides...
Third cousin, probably not, but no guarantee.
At the wedding
fourth
that
cousin,
at.
Like, bro, yeah, I'm flirting with the girlfriend.
At the wedding, I was one of four single people there. That was me, my cousin Oliver, and my two daughters.
Oh, God.
So those are basically the four single people. I had my mom at this gathering. So five, right?
Okay.
My mom, all my sister, that's six. So basically, just my immediate family is the only single people who show up for the most part. Now, if you go to a funeral, what do you have? You have all the people
that this person has known
in their life. It's not an invitation. It's not 100 plates of food that somebody's going to pay for. As many people want to show up as they can. They come from all walks of life. They might have gone to school with this person. There's all types of different scenarios. They are not necessarily 100% your family members.
But it depends on their age. Like, I need someone to die between the ages of 25 and 60.
Right.
I'm just saying where I'm at because, like, a very close family friend died last year. Well, she was like 89. So even if I brought a condom, I mean, you're talking
about... Most of her friends are already dead.
Most of her friends are already dead, and the ones that were alive might not be as I am saying this. You know what I mean? Like, you bring a condom to that, you'd be like, for what? For
well,
who?
Yeah.
Who are you trying to pick?
Okay,
she died 45. She's a family friend.
She has a granddaughter.
That's a good point. Right. See, no blood relation, man.
Right. That's what I mean. I think...
I'm going to your mom's funeral because I'm hitting on that.
I don't think that funeral thing is a weird thing compared to a family wedding. I'm saying not a friend wedding, a family wedding.
I think there's a difference, though. It's one thing if you're the dude that always had the condom in his wallet and you went to the funeral and then you get laid, you go, that's one thing. It's another thing if Mike says, hey, you ready to go to the funeral? I go, hang on, let me grab my condom.
It's like giving you a piece of gum for
right,
your breath.
Exactly. Right. That's
make sure you have this, just in case.
Just in case.
More of the random question coming up, 206-803-ROCK.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
They called him the most powerful man in Hollywood, and he really was for decades.
He extended his tentacles like an octopus throughout the entire entertainment industry.
Mr. Lou Wasserman.
This is Glitter and Might, an Odyssey Originals documentary podcast series written and narrated by me, Sean Levy. All episodes are available on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey, it's Mike Hawk. Join me every Thursday at 1 p.m. exclusively on the Odyssey app as we go live with Odyssey. Join in on the action as we cover interesting facts, top 10 lists, and some fun new games. Follow the Men's Room page on the Odyssey app and join in all the fun Thursday afternoons at 1.
99.9 KISW. We return to the Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
Right, a question, 206-803-ROCK. Call back again.
Try. I don't know, man. Like, it'll light up for a second, and then the call's instantly dropped.
Mm-hmm.
That is where we're at right now.
206-803-ROCK. That means I'll give you guys one. The random question.
Random.
I have some betting odds on this.
All right.
As far as the members of the show.
Random.
How many times in your lifetime would you say that you have been punched in the face, whatever the deal is?
How many times?
How many times?
Oh, dude, I mean...
Less than 10.
Less than 10.
30, 40 times maybe, man.
Maybe
50?
I'd say 30.
I mean, it's hard to know. I'm just thinking back. I mean, during my teen years, man, yeah. Like,
every day after school.
How many times? Yeah, probably 30 to 50, somewhere in that range, I guess.
I got like once or twice.
Once or twice to the face? Wait, you just never got in fights, did
you? I just never got into fights. There was one time that a guy hit me kind of like a double barrel fist punch to my chest. That's the only one that I can really remember. And there might have been another one that I forgot, but I wasn't that guy. I didn't go and get into fights. If somebody was messing with me, I didn't challenge them much. I was a candy ass, man.
I have a punchable face. I think that's the deal. You know what I mean? So I got punched a lot, but I'd run my mouth. But the punch I remember most wasn't even the worst punch I took, just the fastest that someone has punched me in the face. I've told this before, it was the first day of school at a new school because I'd been expelled from my previous school, but it was the first day of the school year. So it's Douglas High School in Baltimore. And I'm there, and my tennis shoes are all ratty because that's just how I roll. But back in the day, everyone's got their Air Jordans, they look all crisp, blah, blah, blah. But a guy, he's hanging out with his girlfriend, a couple other dudes, makes a mention of my crappy shoes, right? And just says something like, damn, man, you're time to get a new pair of shoes. I said, man, don't effing worry about my effing shoes. So I cuss at him. And dude looks at me and goes, do you kiss your mother with that mouth? And I said, no, I kiss your mother with this mouth. And I'm telling you, man, I was getting the f of mouth out before his fist hit me directly in. Like, what's cracking your mama joke or whatever it is. Like, it was not. But that's all I said. That's
what, who would you say in, who would you say is the one person on this planet you would not want to have punch you in the face?
You mean of anyone on this planet?
Yeah.
I mean, any professional fighter.
I was just saying.
I mean, just any freaking professional
fighter. That one guy, though, the heavyweight guy, the real big one.
Oh, Tyson Fury.
Tyson Fury. I think he would be pretty close to the top.
I would put him, and that's the thing. You, for me, you just go up by weight class, and look, I understand even a featherweight's going to take me out.
I'm hard. It might even be a harder shot based on momentum.
I was going to say, but this is the thing, right? So, Tyson Fury, all right? He's a very large man, and there's nothing I can do to prevent him from beating my ass, but his fist is the size of a loaf of bread, so I feel like just with more coverage, it's less sting. Like, he's going to knock me out, there's no question.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like a featherweight hits you with that bony-ass hand, and like you said, the speed with which they punch, I feel like the pain would be more extreme from that.
Right. Okay. Reason we asked, have you been punched and how many times? They say it's a goofy suit, but not a suit of armor. The person who plays the Miami Heat mascot discovered this distinction the hard way Saturday when a PR stunt with MMA fighter Conor McGregor went awry. McGregor walloped Bernie with a fierce left hook.
Oh, yeah.
Then hit poor Bernie again after he hit the floor. And if you watch the clip,
wait, he hit him after he hit the floor?
Oh, yeah, he hit him on the ground.
I saw the video of him knocking him down, and I'm like, I know it's a PR stunt, but still, it's Conor McGregor. Like, hey, don't go full force on this.
When it was over, the unidentified person in the suit went to the hospital emergency room. They received pain relief medication and now resting at home with a nice bag on their face. The irony is it was all a stunt to plug McGregor's pain relief spray.
Oh, you got it.
Called Tidal Sport. The fighter could be seen spraying Bernie with it when the mascot was on the ground. Now the Heat have a partnership with McGregor on the spray. The stunt took place during a stoppage in play and during game 4 of the NBA Finals. And while Bernie was clearly intended to end up on the floor as part of a fake fight, McGregor apparently threw a two-reel set of punches. As for the game, Denver did one and now leads a series 3-1. I believe that game 5 is tonight. But either way, man, can you imagine? He throws a punch.
Yes! Conor McGregor. Professional fighter.
Conor McGregor. Random.
You would think that the mascot random, suit would buy you some random, comfort, but apparently not. Random, I mean, you watch the video, random, it does nothing.
Random.
Hello, Phil. Welcome to the men's room.
Hey, hola, gentlemen.
Hola.
Phil, welcome to the program. Random question. All right, this is an odd one, but let's go with this one. What were you surprised to find when you snooped through your parents' stuff?
Ooh, yeah.
What were you kind of surprised to find?
Oh, man. I mean, I don't know, man. My mom would have whooped my butt if she ever caught me snooping through her stuff, and she always had her door locked pretty good because we were both weed smokers.
I was going to say, so what do you suspect she had in there?
Yeah, if she's locking her door.
Oh, man. For sure, weed. 100%. That's why she was trying to lock us out, so we didn't get in there and steal her weed.
All right. But you don't think there was anything else in there that she was trying to keep from her sons?
Oh, I mean, I'm sure. I'm sure there is. Who knows, though? My mom was kind of a church-going person, so I don't think it would be anything too crazy.
I don't know, man.
But you never know. Sometimes they throw a curve on you and do some stuff that you would never think that a church person
now,
would
do. Now, was your mom married, or did she date around?
No, she was married.
Okay, all right. Well, that not that that changes the scenario as far as the kink you get into.
But. Yeah, I was going to say, maybe. I mean, look, I'm glad to say that when you're a kid, you snoop through your parents' crap. I never really found anything too shocking.
I found a couple Playboy magazines.
I found Penthouse magazine, and once we realized where my dad's stash of Penthouse was, we were careful to put it back perfectly. So that we could continue to enjoy it. But he did figure out one day that my brother and I had obviously figured out where they were because he had them in the closet. But I guess we knocked one of his dry clean shirts to the floor unknowingly.
Uh-huh. And he would know that in a second.
He knows it in a heartbeat. So I remember he came flying down the stairs. He was pissed, man. So he's giving me and my brother, you know, a lot of grief about this. We both, of course, played it off, but he knew that we knew. And we knew that he knew that we knew, because the next time we went to go grab the penthouse for a little personal relief time, they'd been moved. And we have no idea where we put them. And it ended that, man. That was crushing. The other thing I found that was weird, and I didn't realize it as a child, it's when I got older and thought back. And I go, huh. So like anyone, you have a couple boxes that just never get unpacked. And for whatever reason, they keep the crap in there. And we would dig through there. Nothing too interesting. But one of the smaller boxes, there is the little incense cones, right? Which we weren't too up on what incense was at the time. We just knew they had a weird smell. And there were two roach clips that I had seen my father use often when he was doing stuff in the garage. And I just thought it was odd as a child. Because, again, I'm not piecing it together. I'm like 11. Like, why would he have these two roach clips and a box with incense? It never made sense. Because when I've seen them in his toolkit, you know, he's using them.
And what were those little scissor things that, forceps maybe, that he used to use those a lot to smoke weed with?
Right.
That way you didn't have to hold it when it got down to the...
All that stuff was in the box. I think those may have been in there too, or tweezers or something.
Something
right?
Like just...
But as a kid, I just thought, man, my parents usually are pretty organized. I find it odd that there's incense and then there's this tool. Then when I got older and just kind of thought back, I'm like, oh, I get it. All right, man. Cool.
I told you, man, my buddy, not family, but he was like, dude, you got to check this out. So I go upstairs. This is a very conservative, not really conservative, but the neighborhood we lived in was conservative. It was on the East Coast, and it was a, you know, suit and tie kind of an area of the country. Anyway, you just didn't expect people to get, I don't know.
I know better now, but yeah.
Right. But so there was a cover over the bed that looked like where you would put a ceiling fan, but it was one of those plate covers. So it's like it's covering a condo. It's covering a box.
Okay, yeah.
Electrical box. So if you want to hang a light, you want to hang a whatever. So he's only got one screw in him. So the other screw, it's a swivel. So now this thing swivels open. And he janks down this chain. And he's like, check this out, man. And it's got this huge spring in the middle of it.
All right.
And like a kind of like a bouncy, like if you were to put your 2-year-old in a bouncy
Yeah,
in the door, right?
Yeah.
Kind of has that spring on it. And then he showed me the harness. And there's like 3 or 4 different harnesses that clip into this thing. Now, we're getting high. We're already drunk. The ladies downstairs, the neighborhood ladies of the party, do not know where we are and seeing this. But right then and there, you hear someone walk up the steps real quick. And he slams the door and locks it. This is his bedroom. And it's his wife. And she's like, Rick, what are you doing?
Right.
Rick, what are you doing in there? And me and him walk out together. And I'm like... nothing. Miles is getting me stoned. Miles,
right?
Why do you have to get him stoned? I'm like, you got to be kidding me. It doesn't smell like weed in here.
Right.
There's no weed. Like, how did she think we did that? To blow it out the window like we're 12?
I mean, he's showing you the sex swing.
He was showing me the
sex
swing.
When you looked at her, though, knowing, like, because obviously it takes two for that to matter.
You know, they have 4 kids, you know. Like,
well, obviously. I mean, but when you're looking at her, you like, were you shocked that she was a part of this, or were you like, I can see that side of it?
I was more into the mechanics of this unit and all the different things that you could do with it. So I was kind of more like, all right, well, what does this seat do? Or what is this thing for? Or what's the advantage of hooking this one in compared to hooking this
one? But you never got the full detail because she ruined it.
Right, yeah. I got like two of the details out of the 4 swings.
Hey, you're not alone. Somebody here says, when I was surprised to find in my parents' room a strap-on dong. All right. Somebody here says, my sister learned fractions messing with my dad's weed scales. See, there's something. I found my dad's porn and Polaroids of my naked stepmother. She wasn't bad looking, if you want to know, but she did have the 70. One time I found an 8-ball of coke. I was shocked. I can't believe he still had it laying around. And let's see. Yeah, some people basically find the drugs in naked magazines.
Well, as they say, clearing out your parents' home after they pass on, maybe it could be like navigating a junkyard or a gold mine. And for these people, it was a copper mine. A couple in L.A., they were cleaning out their parents' home last year, and they discovered a ton of pennies in a tight crawl space in the back of the basement. Loose pennies, boxes of pennies, crates of pennies, and dozens of bank bags filled with pennies. They estimate there are over 1 million of them, if not more. They didn't say how old they are, but the pennies are copper, not zinc, which the U.S. switched to in the 80s. The problem is, what do you do with 1 million pennies? Their first thought was Coinstar, but they didn't want to lose the 8%. And logistically, it wouldn't work since it would be a pain to get the pennies there, and just a bag or two would probably jam up the machine. So they called around all the banks in the area. None of them are interested in these pennies.
Really?
None of them. One bank manager even warned them not to bring them in, saying they did not have room in their vault to accept bulk pennies. Now, 1 million pennies, $10,000. But the couple thinks there's more value in the uniqueness of the collection. They said it is possible there are rare pennies in there somewhere. They put up ads online saying they'd part with them for $25,000, but they've only received lowball offers back so far. One person offered the copper value, but that proved to be impractical.
What does the copper value? Or do they say?
More than $10,000.
Well, yeah, and I mean, if they're solid copper. Mm-hmm.
So for now, they're going to hold on to them. By the way, it's unclear why the homeowners had stashed all the pennies, but the family believes they intentionally converted paychecks to copper pennies, believing that their value would increase with more and more over time.
Which is great if you're going to cash them in.
So once they maybe switched in the 80s, they started collecting all these pennies.
Oh, all the old ones. And so, okay, hey, look, I got
the value. The value of these are going to be more over time just based on the price of copper.
Now, would it be illegal if you got all of those pennies, right? Because you said it's, what, $10,000 in currency, but you melt down the copper, it's worth a lot more. But I believe it's illegal to melt down money, right? I mean, that's the thing. So you don't want to pay someone.
If I got a $100 bill and I want to rip it up in front of a group of friends, is that a crime?
I believe that it is.
I think so.
I think it's actually a federal crime.
That's not my property. I'm just borrowing it.
Well, no, you're just, yeah. I mean, essentially, you're defacing money. I believe it's a federal crime.
So if I put it in the bank, I can do whatever I want with it, as long as I don't mess with the note itself.
Because I think it's more of it's a representation. It's not necessarily your property. It's the government telling you that you have this much property.
You have this worth.
Right.
Something along those lines.
Right.
So, yeah, I think it'd be illegal to get $10,000 worth of pennies, which is a million pennies, but because they're old, melt them down for the copper value, which is more than $10,000. So, I mean, maybe you buy them and don't tell people that you melted down pennies. I mean, I don't know.
Where do you go to melt down copper?
See, that's the problem with my plan. All right, I got the million pennies. All right, yeah. Where do we go now?
I'm sure a lot of people do.
There could also be an age limit on that thing as far as the pennies go, because there was that family not terribly long ago that found a bunch of money that they were able to transfer the money over and get the switch over value for it, but some of them were just so old they couldn't put a value on it, and so they were pretty much worthless. So there might actually be a date on there since we stopped using copper.
Right.
So that...
Could I melt these down?
That might actually be in the cards, yeah.
And then sell that copper because that's worth more than a penny.
Exactly.
I don't know. Well, give it a try and see if you get visited by... Who takes care of that stuff? The FBI, Secret Service?
For more financial advice, I'm doing a podcast.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Yeah, listen to our financial advice. But melt down your pennies, everyone. Hello, Robbie. Welcome to the men's room.
Hola, bicholas.
Hola.
Robbie, welcome to the program. Random question. Let's do this one. When were you embarrassed to need help? How did you get yourself in a jam and... You needed to call somebody and see if they could help you out of the problem.
Oh, man.
I mean, hell, even if it's from childhood, you know, because Ted had to help a kid zip up his freaking pants in a public bathroom.
Yep.
Which is pathetic.
You ever call a tow truck because your car broke down?
A job? Probably my last job.
Okay.
I was building a rail car, and... I left the bleeder open, and I'm sitting there far away. I'm kind of staring at it, and I was like, oh, something's steaming over there. Didn't think much of it. Come to find out, the bleeder had let out probably close to 100 gallons of hot asphalt all over the floor.
Oh,
man.
And so just pooling up, spreading everywhere. Yeah, nearly lost my job, so I had to call for some help to get it cleaned up. That was a fun few hours.
I bet it was. That's a lot of asphalt.
What do you do to remove asphalt from the floor?
You put diapers on it. They're like pink blankets, absorbent blankets. Try to scoop it up. You can put kitty litter on it to absorb it, make it more malleable.
Okay.
Yeah, kitty litter.
That's all you can do.
Kitty litter shows up a lot. Gasoline.
Pretty good absorbent.
As far as, more runny than not.
Yeah, for sure.
There's a couple of those that works for.
He's talking about asphalt. I saw the story last week. So it's some village in India. All right, they had been complaining about the roads there, blah, blah, blah. So I guess it's funded by the government, or maybe it's a private company, but they came in and they repaved the road. Well, then the people came out and they're pissed off because they said, you laid asphalt, you did not repave the road. They laid a carpet down this road They're trying to do it at night so that no one figured it out, and then laid asphalt on top of the carpet. So the villagers, to the point, basically started lifting the carpet. They literally put asphalt on the carpet. Wow. Yeah, yeah, we repaved the road. They're like, you didn't.
Reason why we asked, where were you embarrassed that you needed help? Marine rescuers in England said a paddleboarder came to the assistance of three men who drifted out to sea on a huge inflatable duck. Volunteers were conducting training exercises when they received word that three men had floated away from the Westward Ho Beach.
Westward Ho, yeah.
On a giant inflatable duck. A friend in a kayak attempted to push the duck to shore, but the unusual flotation device was soon more than 650 feet from shore. Rescuers were on their way to the scene when a man on the paddleboard ventured over to tow the inflatable back to the beach. The paddleboarder, believe it or not, was able to bring the duck close enough to shore for the three men to jump out and return it to the beach. The inflatable was then blown back out to sea.
Oh, yeah.
The duck was then retrieved again by volunteers who dubbed the inflatable Quackers joked at their new apprentice crew member. More of the random question on the way, 206-803-ROCK.
99.9 KISW. The Men's Room returns with Miles and Thrill.
Your guess is as good as my account of our categories. The top 10 most popular things that people leave in Ubers and money. The 10 states that contribute the most to the United States economy. Close your categories with your guess as good as mine right after emails on a random question. 206-803-ROCK.
Hello, Jeb. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Random.
Boom, Richie.
Boom. Jeb, welcome to the program. And the random question. All right, Jeb, let's go with this one. Would you rather be 30% smarter or 90% more attractive?
You know what? I'm going to be straight up with you. I'd rather be 30% smarter because I don't think I'm lacking in the attractiveness, but I definitely do make some decisions sometimes that aren't very smart.
Well, if I'm not mistaken, Jeb, you sent us a picture of your girlfriend, which, you know, you definitely outkicked the coverage on that one, if I remember correctly. But you're also still pretty young.
Yes, sir.
So,
I did.
In your case, I think you might be absolutely right. Because you don't seem as bright.
It doesn't take brains to get that.
Well, it takes a little bit of thought.
She'd appreciate that.
You know, I'm just not thinking with, like, my head brains, though.
No, right? We got you.
Yeah. What, Jeb, what do you do? Are you still in school or do you have a job?
Yeah, man, I'm an intern right now for a big old company.
Okay, what do they got you doing?
Excel spreadsheets, just like automating data and stuff, writing scripts.
So you're obviously pretty intelligent to be able to do that.
Yeah, man, I dabble.
Okay, all right.
I just smoke a lot of weed.
Well, a lot of us do.
Yeah. That's what I've been.
Have a few beers every once in a while, too. I ain't going to kill you. All right. Okay. 30%. You guys, 30% smarter or 90% more attractive?
I'll go 30% smarter.
Same.
Yeah, me too.
I mean, at this point, you know what I mean?
Being this devilishly good looking has not gotten me anything in my life.
You would be surprised, though. Some of the guys that I know that are very good looking, I don't think God gives you everything in life.
Right.
I really don't. I mean, there's the exception to the rule. But I mean, I grew up with kids that ended up being models. Like, seriously, they did that professionally for a little bit of time. Dumber than a box of rocks to talk to. And
sure.
These are guys I knew that I grew up with. Women loved them. I mean, they were,
of course,
they wanted to go out with them all the time. But when you sat down, even with a bunch of guys to just have a good time or whatever, you just realized
just how dumb they are.
And I that's not the case with women. I don't really believe that all the time. Like, yeah, there's beautiful women out there who are smart, intelligent, everything else. Guys, it just seems like the better looking you are, the dumber you are. But it's not always the case, but it just seems like percentage-wise, it seems that way.
Maybe. I don't know. I don't know a ton of really good-looking guys personally. And the good-looking guys you see are generally fairly smart, right? You got George Clooney. All this kind of thing. But granted, you know, these are like A-list celebrities, so being smart kind of helps your brand, so to speak. But I don't know. Next time I see a good-looking guy, I'm going to roll to him, strike up conversations. You're as dumb as I thought you'd be.
Yeah. Well, there's a saying, good looks can only take you so far, but what if the good looks could take you 90% farther? A poll asked 8,000 people, would you rather be 30% smarter or 90% more attractive? And it was close. 53% of people said they'd rather be 90% more attractive, while 46 would choose 30% smarter. So it was right down the middle.
Yeah, but when I go law of averages, just when you walk down the street, right? So not even people you know, but when you just look at the public in general, I think that works out about right. Like about 53%, you could use some help in the looks department, you know, for sure.
People had some reasons. I'm already pretty smart, so I'll take the intelligence.
Much better to be exceptional at one of them than good in both. And also, looks do fade with age. The intelligence, that's going to last your whole life. And on the flip side, quote, I'm smart enough, but being attractive in life is like lowering the difficulty. And I'm smart enough to know that being smarter would only make me more unhappy.
Yeah, if you're that smart. Mm-hmm. Now, they do make a good point. I mean, right, looks fade with age, blah, 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 blah. But in the end, money's going to win. I mean, look at, who is it, Al Pacino?
Well, he's also famous.
That's what I'm saying. He's got money. He's not good looking. And he just, had a kid with his, 29-year-old girlfriend?
Yeah, it seems
and who
it
was
seems
she
a little
dating
strange.
Before she dated Al Pacino?
She dated Mick Jagger for a while.
Right. Another
she,
dude.
She has a history of dating people that are...
Have money.
Wealthy and old.
And old. Yeah.
Like, she just divorced... Who's the main banker guy?
Main banker guy.
Or not, she was like dating him or married to him. One of those guys that you've heard the name a million times whenever they bring him up.
Like Buffett or Soros
Exactly.
Right.
He's just there because he's talking about money.
Well, who was the guy that Anna Nicole Smith back in the day? She married this old dude, right?
A billionaire oil tycoon from Texas.
Yeah, he looked like a liver spot in a wheelchair, right? So, and I'm being nice when I say that. So she marries him. He's like 90-something, all right? And at that time, she's in her early 20s, I believe it was. So his family says, hey, they go to their, you know, this old man and say, she's only marrying you for your money. And paraphrasing, he's like, I know, and I'm marrying her for the sex. He's like, what's the problem?
Right.
He's like, this is so obvious.
Because the kids didn't want to lose their money.
Yeah, that was it. He's like, look, don't worry, you're still covered, but understand, I know why she's here. But she knows why she's here. I'm getting laid, she's going to get rich, but... Did anyone not think that? My God, man. Mm-hmm.
Random.
Hello, Todd.
Random,
welcome to the men's room.
Random. You have your dogs make sure they move it off safely and make them leave.
Hey, Todd, are you there?
No.
Todd?
Hello.
Hello, Todd.
Hola.
What are you doing, Ola?
Ola.
Todd, welcome to the random question.
Sorry, man.
You got dogs, you got women. What the hell's going on over there?
We catch you at a bad time.
Right. Okay.
No, you got me at a good time.
All right. We never know when to call you, Todd. Okay, let's go with this one.
I'm surrounded by women.
Okay. What smell would you say that you hate the most? What is a smell that you're just like,
smelling.
Oh, God. Just awful. Even if it's supposedly a good smell, bad smell, what smell is it that just you just can't stand?
Alrighty. Well, that brings up a good one, don't it? I'm janitorial, so... Boy, I don't know.
You just said you work in janitorial, but you do not know?
Yes, I work in janitorial. Well, yeah.
Okay.
So not too many smells... I would have to. I'm really trying to think of a smell that will not make me gag my ass off.
So, in other words, you've gotten used to all the regular puke, poop, pee, all that stuff, right?
There's a couple more.
Well, what about like liver and onions? I mean, there's certain smells
right.
are just
no. Okay, now we're not going on the taste situation. I love the smell, but I don't like the taste.
Okay, so you like the smell. See, I hate
Wait, you like the smell of liver and onions, but don't like the taste?
No, just like pancakes. I love the smell of pancakes, but I don't like the flavor.
Really?
But not on the flavor.
That's interesting. I don't know anyone that doesn't like pancakes or has an
aversion.
You might say I like waffles better than pancakes.
Sure.
Or I like French toast better than pancakes. But I've never heard anyone say I don't like pancakes.
Yeah, pancakes, there's nothing wrong with pancakes. Pancakes are just pancakes.
Somebody's making pancakes, man. You're like, pancakes. Even if you know, you're going to eat one. You're going to eat a couple of them, no matter what.
For sure. I hooked the kids up with them the other night. Wife's like, hey, man, I'm going out. What do you want to do? The kids for dinner? I said, I got it. All I got to do is go home and say, do you guys want chocolate chip pancakes? And literally, I got home and said, do you guys want chocolate chip pancakes? My son's response, and I quote, was, duh. So, right?
Do you have to make bacon or anything? Like sausage on the side? You hook them up?
No, man. They just want the pancakes. My son will eat like 8 of them. My daughter eats one. But they eat them at the same amount of time.
I find that in the woods, I cannot stand the smell of maple. For whatever reason,
really?
I love maple syrup. I don't like a maple bar, though, because the smell reminds me of the trees. I don't know why that is. I think because when I get maple syrup, it's like Aunt Jemima. So it's really not maple syrup.
Right, it's not
like
maple
I'm
syrup.
Getting it from Canada, like a sap of a tree. So it just doesn't have that pungent smell to it. But and maple to me, I'm like, ugh.
I think the smell I hate that I have to interact with the most, anyway, it's unavoidable, it's just when you change the kitty litter, man. You know what I mean? Like, you pick up dog ass three times a day because your dog's pooping. And obviously, it does not smell great. I know what it is. Fine, right? And it seems like it doesn't matter the animal. On some level, all turds, you know, it's like a dead body. You know something's died when you smell it. If an animal's dropped a deuce, like, you know this animal is just poop, right? It could be a rhino. It could be an elephant. It could be your dog. Somehow, it's a turd. But, man, I don't know what cats do in their body. But when they lay it down and you open that litter box to scoop that thing out, to me, that is the worst absolute smell. And I hate doing it just for that reason.
I go back to coconut again. I know that it's not my favorite flavor, but also when I smell it, for whatever reason, I get upset. It's not that I can't stand it, and it's not that I have to run out of the room when I do, but it's in a lot of different lotions and creams.
It is. Actually, and, funny. At a friend's house last night, someone brought a coconut over, and they'd like... taking the top off, and the kids were trying coconut water, and then they reached in to try coconut. So there's probably 7 kids there. They all hated it.
It's disgusting.
I mean, they put it in their mouth, and they all spit it out within like 2 seconds.
I bet if I bring in a coconut cream pie, you guys will love it.
I don't like coconut taste much.
Man, I would try it because
You've never tried it.
I'm that guy that will try anything before I say that I don't like it, but I do not hold out my hopes. No.
I would say this. Coconut shrimp, I like. After that, I can't think of a... I can deal with it if it's in something, but I really, really don't like it.
Coconut shrimp is probably the best application of coconut that I've had. Because
it doesn't taste like coconut.
Well, you're also having shrimp.
Correct. And somehow, the coconut does not taste like coconut.
Because fish tasted stronger than coconut.
And who thought of just putting that into the batter?
Thank you for
shrimp.
There's
got to be 9 million other things that you can put into the shrimp.
I think once you dry it out, like you put it to use. But coconut itself, man, I don't like the consistency of it. Like, the consistency is like skin. You know what I mean? I feel like when I'm chewing it, like I'm chewing on little bits of flesh if the flesh tasted awful. I would rather eat a person than eat a coconut, right? The consistency is the same, but I don't know what people taste like, but they're meat. So I can deep fry it, something.
Okay. Reason we ask, what smell do you hate? A first century Roman tomb discovered in Carmona, Spain, has pulled researchers nose deep into the history of human sense. According to Smithsonian Magazine, scientists from the University of Cordoba and Carmona City Museum detailed how they detected the distinct aroma of a bygone era, thanks to a vial of patchouli perfume among 6 entombed skeletons. To our knowledge, this is possibly the first time a perfume from Roman times has ever been identified. According to researchers, patchouli is seen as more today of a signature scent of, they say, New Age bookshops, dorm rooms, Grateful Dead concerts.
And people that annoy you.
But it was uncommon, apparently, in toga-wearing times. They note it originated in India. The fragrance was reserved for the wealthy and influential in the ancient Roman Empire. The quartz vial and its stopper suggest the tomb's inhabitants were obviously pretty well off, as perfume's role in the ancient world was far from merely cosmetic. It was a multi-tool function, so olfactory-wise, used after or in lieu of bathing. So in religious rituals, it even is an ingredient in various medicines, believe it or not.
Really?
Yeah. The Romans were not alone in using perfume, of course. Scientists have previously attempted to recreate Queen Cleopatra's preferred scent. Smithsonian reported in 2022...
What did she like?
Researchers revealed the Egyptian ruler was likely surrounded by a potent potpourri of desert date oil, myrrh, cinnamon, and pine resin. According to archaeologists, this is vital, as far as research goes, on knowing scents and how people lived. And as far as their more intimate understanding of ancestors' daily lives, habits, rituals, and the fact that they often use these also in the sexual world, as far as being able to be presentable.
I thought that's what palm oil was. Solo time.
Having to take a bath.
Some people talking about the bad smells. I think some people nailed it. Now, one person says she's a nurse and a GI bleed.
Ooh.
What exactly is a GI bleed?
Gastrointestinal.
Oh, right. Yeah, that explains itself. Someone here says tuna and a can. cannot stand it.
It does have a weird smell when you pop the top. It takes a little while for that stuff
fish
to
fish and metal. I don't know if they go together, but I think this person nailed it. And I don't know anyone that disagrees with this, right? So some people like certain smells. This one, I think, universally hated the smell of clothes that sat in the washer too long.
And you know that when you know it. You walk by that person.
Who you does, know it.
You know also that they don't have a very good sense of smell.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's the worst smell. You're right, dude. That's a horrible, horrible smell.
Have you guys ever smell something that you don't like to smell it, but you gotta sniff it again?
You mean like the lint you pull out of your belly button?
Yeah, exactly.
Right, if you get something on your finger that came out of your teeth.
Give it a whiff, like, ew.
God, that beef. Let me smell that again.
It's been there for days.
You open up, why do we do that?
You open up a jar or something out of the fridge, like, oh, damn.
But you invite other people. When it's food, you invite other people to smell it.
Oh, yeah.
God, this milk smells awful. Smell it. Like, no.
Clip a toenail that got a little too long.
Oh.
Gas guy's got one. Diesel truck's a roll coal. I know you drive a diesel.
Yeah, I do. Can't take my diesel, my car's starting to stink right now, man. It's bad.
The smell of pus. Yeah, I mean, yeah.
I've never smelled pus.
I have once, and unfortunately it was off of my own body. Ooh. And it's indescribable. Yeah, man. And I mean, I can't. It's not quite the smell of rot. It's not quite the smell of poop. It's like if a turd died. Like if a turd was a living creature, then it died. It's also, somehow you mix that.
A dog expressing anal glands.
I've heard that, man.
Oh, geez, man. That is absolutely horrible. Well, and they'll do it, you know, because once those glands get so big that they need to just express themselves. Sure, you could take a dog.
Express yourself.
But they will. I mean, I have walked into the bedroom and the dog had expressed some of that stuff. You have to strip the sheets. I mean, it's worse than someone peeing the bed. You have to strip the sheets.
What is in the dog's anal glands? Because like bulldogs have to get it all the time and all this. Like,
think about it this way: it's the back end of everything, right?
Right.
And those sacs, if you will, kind of become a little bit infected from all the fecal matter.
Oh God! So it's like infection and poop.
Right.
Think of it like popping a zit of poop.
Okay.
And the way that theirs is constructed is different than ours. So the way that things
I've never had to do it. I don't want to do it.
This is kind of an Audi as opposed to R&E.
Ew, man.
So, yeah.
Have you had to do it?
To express it, no. But honestly, recently, the Brillo pad had a, not a cyst, but his, one of the glands did get infected. And he's, over the last few days, abscess, that's the word, had an abscess back there that over the last couple of weeks, we've had to give him medication, and it has had to let out, and he let it out all over our bed. So we had to clean off the old duvet cover.
Nah, man. Just buy a new one.
Right.
Like, seriously, like, don't even bother with the washer, man. If that is what's on, like, just buy a new one.
Keep him off the pad.
God. Hello, Brandon. Welcome to the men's room.
Hello.
Hola.
Brandon, welcome to the program. And write a question. Hey. Question.
All yes, right. Sir. So the smell for the nose candy, the first time that you hit it off the key, and then you can kind of get the gags, and then it's really bad smell, I guess.
Yeah, that's not a good one. All right, let's go with this question for you. Who are who are you friends with now that you used to not be or that you used to hate?
Friends that got me into trouble, which exactly what I was just talking about. Not going to the bars and the clubs and staying up all night.
And are you friends with those people now?
Oh, yes, sir. Yeah, we're all older now, so.
All right. Okay.
Yeah, I mean, it's how it goes.
I mean, half the time, you know who you're getting into a fight with. If you've been punched in the face 50% of the time, it's an associate, it's a friend, it's someone you know.
Sure.
I mean, you might not be best friends, but typically things get heated among friends that are closer. So,
yeah.
Oftentimes, I mean, like, I've gotten in more fights with my roommate's friends. Everything was fine the next day. But at the same point in time, you know, you know them very well. Very, I mean, yeah, she'll get into a random argument or a fight. But I typically think it's, not friends, but just people that I did not like that I used to have to work with.
Sure.
But now that I don't have to work with them on a day-to-day basis, and it's not something that, you know, you need to deal with personally.
How about Josh?
To get your job done.
We get along with this guy, Josh, great. Now, you met him, right, Mike? We're down in Vegas, and we were telling you stories of what we got away with under his eye.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
All right.
So this guy, when we worked with him, I mean, I want to say he threatened legal action on Miles once.
He did, because
we're
going
to beat his ass up. All this stuff.
We're going to put
a monkey in his office.
And then on our last day there, and that's, we thought he hated us too, right? So we just did not get along ever. There was never a good conversation. And our last day that we're saying goodbye, we're still going to say goodbye to him because we worked with him, whatever. And he was just like, run. I mean, he was like, get out of here. And since then, dude, we've gotten tight.
Yeah.
He's great.
Reason we asked about who are you friends with now that you used to hate in the new Netflix docuseries, Arnold. Arnold Schwarzenegger and Sylvester Stallone dive deep into their race to be the biggest action star of the 80s. Stallone says the rivalry got so heated, we couldn't even stand to be in the same room together. People had to separate us. They're good friends now, and Stallone is even willing to admit Arnold was better. He's superior. He just had all the answers. He had the body. He had the strength. That was his character. He said, I used to get my ass kicked constantly, whereas Arnold, he never got hurt that much. And I'm going, Arnold, you could go out and fight a dragon, and you come back with a Band-Aid. Meanwhile, Sylvester Stallone's getting his ass beaten by Dolph Lundgren.
Yeah.
By the way, real quick, a great text just came in.
Oh, yeah.
We were talking about expressing a dog's anal glands. Yeah. So they're called anal sacs. I had a client once that told his client once that his dog had anal sacs, and he grabbed his dog and stomped out of the clinic, and at the front counter, he yelled, my dog is not gay. I can't believe you'd say he has anal sacs.
All anal sacs.
Yeah, and they're like, oh, your dog has anal sacs. Like, no, he does not. He must have drank a Bud Light. I thought I poured them all out.
Your guess is as good as mine. Cut out of the categories Ubers and money. You are listening to The Men's Room.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
They called him the most powerful man in Hollywood, and he really was for decades.
He extended his tentacles like an octopus throughout the entire entertainment industry.
Mr. Lou Wasserman.
This is Glitter and Might, an Odyssey Originals documentary podcast series written and narrated by me, Sean Levy. All episodes are available on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
What's up? It's your boy, The Ben Smith. Thanks for listening to the Men's Room Daily Podcast. Want more? Check out the greatest podcast in all the land, The Podcast. Be sure to subscribe and listen to a brand new episode every Tuesday night.
The debauchery rolls on. You're listening to The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill. 99.9 KISW.
Your guess is as good as mine. Cut up our categories. The most common things left in Ubers and the states that make the most money for our economy here in the United States. But first time for a few emails from the men's room at KISW.com.
You've got mail. You've got mail.
As far as the smell, gentlemen, I cannot think of very few other things that smell as bad as a dead body that's been sitting in a single-wide trailer in 90-degree heat for 2 weeks. I'm a deputy and have responded to quite a few of these. That is not pleasant. That from Justin. All right, let's see here. I'll move on to the birthday request. Pacholas, my oldest son, is 11 today. So can I request Miles giving some inspiration on swimming and getting older? I think Coach Ted is out, trying to ask for his advice as well. Thanks, guys. That from Mom, Dad, Diller, and Will. Swimming, huh? I'll give you a couple jokes here. Since you're 11 years old, tell some swimming jokes. Why do dolphins only swim in the salt water? Why do dolphins only swim in salt water?
I don't know.
Because pepper makes them sneeze. Why can elephants swim wherever they want?
Why?
Because they always have their trunks. And finally, why don't vegetarians swim in competitions?
Why don't vegetarians swim in competitions?
Because they don't like meats. Guys, my beautiful wife, Lindsay, is turning 38 today, a Washington native, listens to you guys every day for real, has converted me to the Men's Room fandom. Now we live in your favorite state of Florida. For the birthday, can she please get the Dirty Germans talking about what a 38-year-old blonde bombshell from Washington will be doing living in Florida and what she might be up to? Thanks, guys. Seattle native, huge Tampa Bay Lightning fan, also loves green beans as well. And she wants a D. Please and thank you, guys. That from Jay and Lenz.
Green beans. What? Green beans.
She wants green a D, beans. And she's going to get one.
Green beans.
Yeah, we saw a picture of this woman who, which you're speaking. What I would suggest is that maybe tonight for your birthday, you go and visit Busch Gardens.
Jump into an alligator pit.
Like the story that Mike's got coming up in the headlines.
Yeah.
But y'all, today on a birthday, shout out to my girlfriend of 13 years, my mistress, Manders. She is 36 this year. Can she get a, she wants a D, and the dirty German talking about the fun she'll have if she leaves the door open. Thanks, guys. That from her servant, Enrique.
She wants a D, and she's going to get one.
Yeah, of course you'll have more fun if you leave the door open, but I imagine he wants you to leave that back door open so that he can have fun, too. Yeah.
Guys, I failed my boyfriend Kyle Stewie last year, so I have to make sure I don't drop the ball this year too much. Hell of a guy who has never stopped giving up for what he believes in or knows what's right. And I know hearing a shout-out will make him smile, and that's the best gift that I can give him. But, of course, I don't remember which ones he likes. So can you help him celebrate by just giving him a bunch of your favorites? Most likely he will agree. Thank you, guys. Have a beautiful day. That from Dez.
Uh-oh, look out.
Holy guys. Love the show. Got my fiancé hooked many years ago. He's been listening ever since. Today is my fiancé Rainier's 40th birthday. We've been together 11 and a half years so far. For his birthday, can I get Coach Ted? I can't get Coach Ted. He's out. They're going to the Mariners tonight, though. And maybe some words of wisdom from Miles about turning 40. Thanks, guys. From his loving lady, Kate, a.k.a. River. All right. Rainier, you know you're getting old. And in your 40s, when you can't walk past a bathroom without thinking, well, I may as well pee while I'm here. I know I'm going to have to go later, but I'm right by the door, so let's try to go in and get something out.
Get something out, yeah.
I'm here. Guys, I found, let's see here, two different instructions. I am texting and emailing. Just send us an email if you want birthday requests. Men's room at KISW.com. I don't know which are his favorites, so give him the works. He commutes home this time every day. That from, birthday is from Ty, I believe, and that's from his lovely girl, Lisa.
Can I buy you a fish sandwich?
Happy Chinooka.
Do not die for my father or my boss.
All right, guys, here you go.
Happy birthday to you.
Yaws of Dirty Germans brought to you by Men's Room Original Sausage. Available through Uli's World Famous Sausage, mensroomlive.com, and other fine retailers. Schweinefleisch.
Thank you, Mom. Let's get a contest on the line for your guest is as good as mine now at 206-803-ROCK. Couple extra ones here. What I got away with until I didn't. Hi, guys, catching up on the podcast on the Odyssey app. This was a close one, sort of. When I was a unsupervised high school student with a grip of fireworks, I was at a buddy's house. His parents were out of town, so we were in the garage blowing stuff up, taking bricks of Black Cat firecrackers, pulling them off into singles, taping them to action figures, and what you have there, you would, whatever it was, maybe funny to explode. Anyway, around 1 a.m., we're so tired to the point that everything was funny. My buddy suggested trying to flush one black cat and see what would happen. We made it up to the guest bathroom, and sure enough, it went down. No big theatrics, but a loud clunk, and then the side of the toilet shattered. Shrapnel blew all over the floor, water flooding everywhere. My buddy was on the ground in tears laughing. The only thing I could do was look at the mess and say, "Oh, God," repeatedly. Thankfully, enough, we calmed down, got the water off, and cleaned up. And back when stores were 24/7, we made it to Home Depot at 3:40 in the a.m. to buy and install a new toilet. We got away with it for months until one day his mom made his dad use that bathroom. He was sitting, finishing up his business, and stretching, and noticed a sparkle on the ceiling. He then had to ask his son why there was porcelain shrapnel in the ceiling.
Oh.
He explained the story. However, since we did what was needed to be fixed, he did not get in trouble. We'll never live that down, and we're told to never do it again. Cheers and thanks, guys, for all you do for the show. Love the laughs from the best rock station and the best radio show that is out there. That from Scott. All right, time for a little Your Guess as Good as Mine. It's an easy game to play. We get a contestant on the line. You pick from one of two categories. Try to get as many right in said category before three strikes and you're out. So, Steve, who is our contestant? Ready to play Your Guess is as Good as Mine.
Hello, Justin. Welcome to the men's room.
Ahoy.
Ahoy.
Justin, welcome to the show. And your guess is as good as mine. All right, our categories for you, Justin. The 10 most common things that people forget in Ubers, as surveyed by Uber drivers. Then we have the states that are pulling their weight for the U.S. economy. Wallet Hub ranked the best states as far as three main categories: economic activity, meaning factors such as GDP changes, export per capita, startup activity, also economic health, unemployment rates, innovation potential. So do you want to go like the 10 states that are making the most money for the country, or do you want to go the top 10 things left in Ubers?
Well, I think we'll go with the Ubers because I can probably name off, you know, 30 of the states. So I'll lose that one for sure.
Okay.
All right. So let's go with the Uber.
All right. Have you ever left something behind in an Uber, they ask? You're not alone. It happened constantly. Uber released a list of the 10 things that people left behind the most over the past year. We have those. They also shared some of the weirder things that people have left behind over the past year.
Mm-hmm.
Those include a Danny DeVito Christmas ornament, a fog machine, an ankle monitor, a unicycle, 16 ounces of fake blood, a green foam statue of Liberty Crown, a lightsaber, two hamsters, six cheesecakes, fingernails, a bidet, rash cream, a pregnancy test, a slushy machine, a fake tooth, and someone's painting of their wife. But you need to figure out what the most 10 popular things that people leave behind are. You know the game's played, Justin. Try to get as many right in the category before three strikes and you're out.
Okay. Let's start off with the obvious one, cell phone.
Cell phones are number two. That is correct. That was probably, and that's the one that I think would panic a lot more people the most.
Sure. Yeah.
The funny thing is, how do you get it back? Because now you don't have a cell phone to call your cell phone.
Exactly. Hopefully they find it.
That's always the problem.
Mm-hmm. I did it in Vegas. Places. And the problem with Vegas is my airplane ticket was on there.
Oh, God. Right.
Like everything I need's on that phone. Okay.
Wallets or purse?
Wallets is number four. Purses and backpacks, number three. All right.
Ooh, I got two of them in one.
Look at what you did. All right.
Nice work.
Okay, how about keys?
Keys, number seven. Believe it or not, people still have keys.
Okay. Let's go with clothing.
Clothing is the number one thing.
Assuming jackets.
Jackets,
hopefully
hats,
not pants.
Gloves.
Mm-hmm. Shoes. I left my pants in the Uber, man.
Yep. So far, you're halfway to home. Justin, clothing, phones, purses, backpacks, wallets, and keys. You've got 5 out of the 10, and no strikes against you.
What about, like, cosmetics?
Okay, and I'm gonna guess luggage is categorized as, like, backpack or something like that.
I would guess so, too, yeah.
Some suggestions from the texters here. They say loose change.
Money, yeah.
Any kind of earbud. Yeah.
Cosmetics, I was thinking.
Right. Cosmetics, that's strong.
Lotions and perfumes and makeups.
I like the headphones.
Headphones? All right, let's go there. Yep. Number five.
Not bad. All right.
I'll go with them and say cosmetics.
Oh. No cosmetics.
Don't listen to Mike.
Sorry.
Dang it, Mike. You got me.
My bad.
Somebody here says vomit.
I've never ridden in an Uber, so I've definitely never left anything behind in one of those.
But I will say, you know what? Vomit makes me think. Did they leave their lunch in there? How many people that like have a to-go lunch?
Oh, okay. Now I'm going to listen to Mike. How about just food, leftovers, doggy bags?
I told you not to listen to
you
Mike.
You fool.
You know
why?
Mike.
You know why? Because the Uber drivers don't report that because they don't care because they take that food home and they eat it.
All right.
Sweet.
Somebody here says eyeglasses. That's pretty strong.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I guess I ain't got nothing to go off of. Let's go with glasses.
That's all right. You had a good run while it lasted. You got 6 out of the 10. Those include keys at number 7. 5 is headphones. Wallets at 4. Purses and backpacks at 3. Phones at 2. And clothing number 1.
The hell else are you breaking in?
Prosthetic leg. How about jewelry?
Jewelry number 6.
See, now you should listen to Mike.
Yeah. I'm just thinking everything that's on me, you know.
Umbrellas.
No umbrellas.
That's a good guess.
I guess if it's raining out, you're going to remember your umbrella.
You should probably take an Uber if you normally would have walked.
Jackets, keys, what's inside your pockets, headphones.
I'm trying to think. Wallet.
What about like electronics, like your a laptop computer?
Laptop's number 9.
All right.
That's a big one.
How many more do we have to go?
Two. You've got 2 left. Number 10 and number 8. So far, correct on clothing number 1, phones number 2, purses and backpacks at 3, wallets are 4, headphones 5, jewelry 6, keys 7, and laptops 9.
Maybe somebody here says flatulence. Very true.
Well, that's normally the driver.
Somebody says my wife left her ID. Is that separate from wallet or is ID on the list?
Wallets are in there. If you have your ID in there, though, that works.
Anybody leave like drinks in the car? Then again, they wouldn't report that, would they?
Yeah, depending what it is.
Just drugs. Drugs.
Yeah.
Ooh, drugs.
No drugs.
No drugs.
They won't report it.
Yeah, no.
Oh, man, I found a big 8-ball of Coke. You don't tell people that.
Ah, their baby.
What else do people carry on them?
Right? Because I think we already covered the luggage from the back, because that falls into, like, backpacks.
There's one specific piece of jewelry that's separate from jewelry on here.
Watches?
Watches.
Oh,
okay. That comes in at number 10.
I wrote that one in there.
I don't know why they separate those, so I always consider a watch to be jewelry.
Oh, here's a good one. Why are you taking phone charger.
Phone charger should be number one. It's not.
No,
that's typically in the hotel you leave that one in.
Yeah, and sometimes they'll even have chargers there for you.
Is this something most people have on them?
I would not say this is old school, but it, seemingly in this world, it's a little bit old school.
It's a little on the old school side. Are we talking like, you know, 90s old school, or are we talking like 60s old school?
We're talking old school from this point in time, before time.
Okay, so it's immediate old school.
Ah, imagine. And always old school. This has been very popular up until the last 10 years.
Vapes. No. Cigarettes.
That's not a bad guess. That's not on the list. I would be so pissed if I left my cigarettes in the middle.
Oh, God, yeah.
That would be angry just like a wallet.
I'd almost expect to be reaching for one on the way out.
Yeah. The number 8 thing that people leave in Uber's books.
Oh, yeah. Books. All right.
So we have
old school.
That's right. The top 10 goes like this. Watches at number 10, laptops at 9, books come in at 8, keys are 7, jewelry at 6, headphones at 5, wallets are 4, 3 is purses and backpacks, 2 are phones, and the number 1 thing that people forget in Ubers, that would be clothing. Coming up, we'll drink your toast with a shot of the day. You are listening to The Men's Room.
99.9 KISW. The shenanigans continue. This is The Men's Room with Miles and Thrill.
Right, coming up, we'll drink your toast for the shot of the day. And we do have your headlines on the way at 5:50. But first, quick check in with Mike Hawk and some of the stories and headlines he is not working on.
All right, there's a groundhog infestation in Toledo, Ohio.
What?
They've been infested with groundhogs.
Huh.
Which, how big of a problem is that? From what I understand about groundhogs, they're just big fat rats that sit in, you know, stumps.
They're on a lake. They don't have wharf rats.
I say, do they eat people's crops?
Right?
Like, are they a nuisance other than just, you know, being there?
Exactly. They're just big rodents, aren't they?
I guess. I don't know.
And even then, it's like, okay.
And now what? I mean, it's groundhogs, man.
Hey, congratulations.
They're not killing your pets. I don't know. Maybe they suck. I have no idea. Maybe they're aggressive. No, they're not aggressive. Jesus, I don't know.
How to tell that we don't have a groundhog problem here.
Yeah, that's how you know.
An 18-year-old man in Massachusetts was arrested for donating gift cards to ISIS.
I saw that.
Like Dick's Sporting Good cards and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Enjoy the Target gift card.
Thank you.
All right. Walgreens debuted a new store design in Chicago where nearly everything is stored in the back and employees shop for you after you order your things. So
they're trying to prevent retail theft.
They don't say that at all, Miles.
Yeah, right. Just tell us what you want. We'll grab it for you.
Exactly. And that's what they got these nice little kiosks up there at the front. So it's kind of like what you can do at like a McDonald's when you walk in there. They have the screen there where you can ignore all the employees and just kind of order the things the way that you want it to. And then after a while, it'll just make its way on out.
The thing is, how long do I have to wait?
I would
You know what I mean? If I'm physically there, I would rather just do the shopping.
Sure. And if you're going into a Walgreens, you're either getting beer or cigarettes.
Yeah, like, for the most part.
Let's face it, we're not getting a whole lot when we're running in there. So, you know, if it was a different store, you know, like an Amazon store or something like that, where I might be grabbing a handful of things.
What if it's an embarrassing purchase, like Rid, because you got crabs?
Oh, yeah.
I'd feel better about doing that. Like, yeah, let me just
do it. It's delivered in a paper bag, so they were going to see it anyway when you checked out with
for
it.
For sure.
So,
but I'm not standing in line with other people who also notice that I have Rid in my hand. And keep checking for a change in my pocket. Like, you're not fooling anybody.
Damn. There's a video of an AI-created Blue Jays commercial going viral that's the stuff of nightmares. Have you guys seen this thing?
I have not.
Like the Toronto Blue Jays?
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly. Wow. Hang on. I might be able to look this thing up and get you guys to watch this thing because it is. You know, you guys remember not terribly long ago that they made the AI commercial that was the pizza commercial, right?
Yes.
Which there were some things that weren't okay with it, but it wasn't right. All bad, right? And so then now we have this Blue Jays commercial. Come on over here and check this thing out. So it starts innocently enough. Like, you can tell that it's AI generated because all the faces look semi-similar, yet they don't hold enough shape. You know, there's the crowd. We're inside the stadium, and everybody's got their blue hats. None of the logos look right, by the way.
That kid looked weird.
They all look weird, dude. We got this guy.
Oh, God.
And it just gets worse. Everybody's smiling, having a good time. There's a kid drinking beer at some point. He's going to show up. There he goes. And then when they start diving into like concessions, there's hot dogs and fries and there's weird gelatinous stuff everywhere. Like, this thing just descended into a horrible reality.
I think we do at baseball.
It got really, really bad. Wow. And there's a jingle on top of it that's like, "Go Blue Jays, we love baseball," like that kind of stuff. And the problem is that it's there's the Blue Jays logo. The thing is that it's not awful, because as far as the AI goes, you can, it looks like it was just like something was wrong with the camera,
kind of,
you know what I mean?
That was disturbing.
That was really disturbing,
because how AI seems to interpret how we celebrate things at a baseball game. You're right, that was very nightmarish.
Yes, it yeah,
God almighty,
this looks like you took, you know, a mushroom before you started watching
and you're
TV.
Having a real bad trip, man.
Right,
golly.
Yeah. Looks like a creepy pasta, man. Doggone it. Pizza Hut is testing a new pickle pizza.
Don't.
Man!
What else is with it? So obviously sauce, cheese, and then what, just pickles?
Yeah, right? That might just be it.
I guess.
Which, to be honest with you, it doesn't sound awful.
I mean, I hate pickles, but I guess it makes
I'll
sense
try
if
anything.
You like pickles.
Sure. I'll try it.
My only problem with pickles, well, I don't like the taste of pickles, but to me, on a pizza, if you're putting them on before you cook it, I get the feeling it'd be like anchovies, where it just dominates everything. Like I said, if a pickle spear touches my sandwich, like half of my sandwich tastes like a goddamn pickle.
Sure. It was weird when I was in North Carolina. I got a couple different hamburgers, and both of them had sweet pickle slices on top. And I used to dill pickle slices on a hamburger. So it wasn't the worst thing in the world. It was just a way different tasting hamburger. Just based on the pickles alone. It was not bad at all.
Okay.
It was just different.
All right. Fair enough.
I mean, I'm in.
I'm not used to my hamburgers tasting sweet.
No. I'm with you. So I'd give it a go, but it would have to be the right hamburger.
I saw that some pizza chain in Michigan, maybe? Anyway, they let AI come up with a new pizza to serve.
Okay.
Basically, it's, I guess, whatever this place is, they have, at least locally, they're known for the ranch dip.
All right.
So the ranch dip was the base, then mozzarella. It actually did not sound awful.
Man, with a ranch base.
With the ranch base. Hey, anyway, they're going to give it a try and see if people like it.
Right. Hey, crazier things have happened. Only 8% of people like to be greeted when they walk into a store.
I don't mind it.
I don't mind being greeted. We had this conversation last week. I don't mind being greeted. I mean, my God, it's a decent thing to do. My problem is the cynic in me believes you are now going to follow me around the store.
Sure.
As the salesperson. Like, I do not like when a salesperson shadows you when you're just trying to buy something.
So you prefer the Walmart-style greeting?
Yeah, hey, right. Hey, then they're done, you know, Home Depot.
I don't need you to help me look for something.
Right.
Unless I ask you.
I will ask you.
Because then I'm in a Home Depot.
Right.
Right, but even like the car dealership, and we know you're going to come out, but it's like, dude, give us some breathing room.
Right.
We're already looking at the car, and unlike the grocery store, you have a much more limited selection of vehicles. You might have 7 models. So if we're interested, it's going to be 1 of 7.
Exactly.
We don't need a whole lot of conversation about this, man.
Right.
God, I don't like when salespeople shout at you.
And how often do they say something that really does change it to where, you know...
Other than don't buy it.
Right.
Like
And to be fair with you, they are turning maybes into yeses.
Sure.
They're not taking the no's and turning them into yeses. They're taking the maybes kind of, well, can I make it happen? And they're turning those into yeses.
Correct.
But,
yeah, just I
like you
hate
said,
being shadowed.
Give me a minute, man.
Give me a freaking minute.
Just give me a minute. That's all I'm asking. Well, needless to say, there's a lot of people in this room that they'll take advantage of certain situations and loopholes, and just, we all know that you're lying through your teeth, but it's a life hack that we use anyway, guiltlessly.
I do it all the time.
Which brings us to
the Men's Room Top 10.
Great segue.
The Men's Room Top 10.
Shameful life hacks that people admit to but don't regret. This one works every time. You know you have to have a movement, but you don't want the rest of the bathroom to hear the kersplash. Tear off a length of toilet paper, put that in a bowl, and it will keep it from resonating so the rest of your stallmates don't know what a pig you are.
Yeah.
It's not the splash that bugs me, man. It's the noise before the splash. Yep.
Oh, yeah.
Like I said today, my stomach was messing with me this morning, man.
Yes,
and I went to the bathroom here, and I'm like, it sounded like the bayou at night. Just, I'm like, oh, my God, just poop, man. What is with all the noises? You know what I mean? Like, just do the dirty work.
Just needs the symphony, man.
God.
10 shameful life hacks people admit to but don't regret. Number 10 being taking advantage of loopholes in the law in general.
Well, yeah.
Some people admitted to taking advantage of loopholes in the laws to get what they want. One person shared that they once parked in a no parking zone and left their car there all day because they knew that the city wouldn't tow it due to a legal loophole.
Whatever the legal loophole was.
Right. Do a no parking zone.
If I knew that, then yes, I would do it.
A lot of times I'll leave, like when my kid parks out front and she doesn't have a zone parking permit pass, right. Whatever. I'll tell her, leave the ticket on the car. She went around out there and grabbed it. I'm like, as soon as you take that ticket off the car, they're going to ticket you again.
Yeah, leave the ticket there.
Oh.
Because once they see that you haven't got it yet, they're not going to give you another one. But if it's gone and you're still parked there, they're going to write you another ticket.
Oh, gotcha.
Mm-hmm. Another hack would be to keep the envelope of the ticket that you got before.
And just stick it in your windshield.
And always just put it on your windshield.
There you go.
I would never do that, but...
Mm-hmm.
If I had done it, I would have done it successfully several times.
So this is what we mean by we don't condone the behavior, but if you're going to do it smart.
That's all.
Number 9, I wonder how many people have done this. Pretended to be sick to get out of work. Some people confessed to calling in sick when they weren't actually sick to get out of work. One person said that they would fake a cough on the phone to make their boss think that they were really sick.
I don't think I've ever, I mean, I've lied to get out of work, but I don't think I ever used the sick thing.
Right.
You know what I mean? You come up with something else, because even when you are sick, no one believes you. Dude, yeah. You know what I mean? It's just one of those delays. Also, if you're sick on a Friday or Monday, no one believes you.
No,
even if you're
especially when it looks like this.
Yeah, exactly.
I do a lot better just getting my body moving and going to work. I mean, I feel great in the morning.
Right.
But as long as I get my body moving, I'll figure it out.
Exactly. My wife had a coworker that ended up sick an awful lot.
Well, you know those people. You know the people at your work that call in sick with some frequency.
Mm-hmm.
And some people say, well, they give you sick days for a reason. Well, they do in case you get sick.
Right.
That's all.
But now you're just ruining it for the rest of us.
Correct.
But one thing we do have at this company, I think it's 3 days a year, they call it, personal day.
Oh, we get three. So, we get personal days?
So my thing is, like, hey, I'm not coming into work today. Why? It's personal. I'm not saying I'm sick. So clearly, this is a personal day. It's personal. Don't worry about it.
All right.
Yeah. I don't even know what that means, like a personal day.
It's a personal day.
Yeah, it's weird.
It's personal, man. Okay. Shut up. Taking a personal day.
Don't worry about my business. It's personal.
See, sometimes I wish I had a job where taking a personal day really was as easy as just calling it in and saying, I'm taking a personal day. There is so much crap that I got to do to take a personal day.
I know.
Doggone it, man. Number 8, using fake reviews. Several commenters admitted to using fake reviews to boost their business or harm their competitors. One person shared that they paid people to write positive reviews for their restaurant on review sites like Yelp.
I mean, if you're paying them, it's whatever, man. I don't generally go to Yelp anyway.
Yeah.
Like, other people's opinions of whatever does not matter to me so much.
I agree.
You know what I do find interesting, though? Like, a lot of movies, you know, they'll put up the text as, like, you know, greatest movie ever made, you know, incredible action. Look to see who provided the comment.
Yes.
Because sometimes you see, like, you know, Variety Magazine. I go, okay, this is what they do. Other times I'll realize this is somebody's, like, Twitter handle.
Exactly.
And I'm like, okay, so this 13-year-old kid who's eating boogers really liked the movie.
Right.
And said that, but they use it as part of their advertising thing, so I can't help but do that.
I look for the little three dots before the quote.
Right. And that's the other thing. It says a lot, you know, there's a movie recently.
Captivating.
Did that.
really terrible.
Right. And you realize, like, right, that was a negative review. You took two words that sound good together right. and put it up there. Yeah.
Blew my mind.
We're not lying.
How bad this movie was.
Right.
10 shameful life hacks that people admit to but do not regret. Taking advantage of return policies. Similar to taking advantage of company policies, some people admitted to abusing store return policies to get their money back for items that they no longer needed or wanted. When a commenter shared that they, after they bought a dress for a wedding,
I know a lot of women that do this, and it's always clothes.
At that point, if you're a clothing store, do you ever believe anybody that is turning a wedding-style dress back?
I mean, right, that's the thing. You bring back a t-shirt, I go, okay. Sure. They don't like it, it doesn't fit, whatever, but right. You bought this $400 dress. It's obviously for a specific occasion. Back of these dresses, you're not wearing them more than once.
Yeah.
Assume it's coming back. Hell, my sister-in-law's like, oh, yeah, I'll just buy something. Make sure you keep the tag on it.
Right.
Wear, you know, just tape the tag to the inside. Wear it, then return it when she's done. It's like, damn, man.
Right. Come on. How many times are you wearing stuff to, like, weddings and other events or things that you're buying from the store that other people legit just wore for the day?
Maybe they should have, like, rent a dress, like they do with the tux.
Yes!
So if you need to go get a tux, whatever, just rent the damn thing.
Is your friend getting married? Yeah. Here's the horrible dresses she's going to pick for you.
$125, you're in, you're out, you're done.
Dude, I say we start this business. All three of us go in on this thing. Don't tell anybody, they'll steal the idea.
Mm-hmm.
10 shameful life hacks that people admit to but do not regret. Shoplifting. Straight up shoplifting. It says, while not everyone admitted to shoplifting, a few commenters said that they had stolen items from stores before. One person said that they would steal small items like candy bars and lip balm because they didn't want to pay for them.
Really? Hmm. I mean, at an age, maybe. When I was a teen, sure. You probably blipped at some little things. But as an adult, well, I did steal a pair of shoes once from Value Village. But that was years ago.
Yes.
And I just put them on and walked out.
I still find it hilarious that I can walk into certain areas of a store that has desirable items. But then when you walk by that cosmetic section, that one's got the cameras all over the place.
All over. Yeah, makeup's a huge thing.
It is, man. There's one store. I have gone shopping with my wife. There is one store that has security standing at the door, and that is Ulta.
Really?
Makeup shop.
They should.
Yeah.
Stuff's expensive.
That's right.
And small.
That's exactly right. That is exactly right. Using expired coupons. Several commenters shared stories about using expired coupons to save money. One person said that they would use a 20% off coupon that had been expired years ago and still worked at their local craft store.
Still work. I just assume that when they scan it or whatever the hell they do, that it'll pop up like, hey, this is...
The expiration date's arbitrary anyway.
And to be honest with you, man, I don't know that I've ever looked at the expiration date of a coupon.
No.
Like, if I cut a coupon, then I plan on buying that item within 1 or 2 days.
Right.
That's just me.
I'll look at the expiration date if it's hanging on the fridge. Hey, we should take advantage of this.
Right.
That then goes on for months. Doesn't actually happen. And there's like coupons to go to like AMC, the free tickets and whatnot. It's like, this expired last year.
I'd save them and never use them.
Yes.
I'm always like, oh, this would be a great deal. And I never do it.
Can't do it.
Mm-hmm.
Doggone it.
Yep.
10 shameful life hacks people admit to but do not regret. Claiming fake allergies to get out of social events.
Oh, sure.
See,
social events you don't want to do. Like, in a work, you have some obligation to be there. So, yeah, you might fake like you're sick. But, man, if you don't feel like doing something, if you're not the center of it, then whatever. But if you tell people, I just don't want to go, then you get nagged about it, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So you come up with something else.
Right. Sure. And then the problem is that when they know that that's the case, but then they keep digging, like, do you really want me just to break you down right here? No, I don't want to go.
I don't want to go.
I don't want to go.
I don't like your friends.
Right. All I'm going to do is just stand around and be the one that's drinking all damn day.
Right. Then you get mad at me because I'm going to be drunk.
Right. I don't want to go.
At you.
I'm sorry, Auntie. Let's see here. Taking advantage of company policies. One commenter shared that their company offered a no-questions-asked return policy on electronics. They'd buy a new TV or a game console, use it for a week or two, and then return it for a full refund. While technically not illegal, this type of behavior is unethical and can harm the company's bottom line.
Why would you take back a TV after you had it for a week?
I'm thinking
I mean, don't you need the TV ultimately anyway?
I mean, if it's like the week after the Super Bowl, I understand maybe why, but...
Sure.
Generally speaking, I can't think, hey man, I'm going to get this TV for a week. I'm going to binge all the shows I want to watch, then no TV again for a while. Why would I...
I have a Netflix account, but not a TV. I just need to watch this on the big screen.
Man, that's like having cigarettes without a light.
That's right.
Wait, you have Netflix, but you don't have TV. That is correct. Okay.
Sometimes I just rub it on the ground real hard, see if the friction will work. Lying on resumes. At this point in my life, I'm surprised that nobody has.
I'm sure people exaggerate a little.
Fudge. The stupidest thing about it, you can confirm most of the things on a resume if you're applying to a company that cares enough to research it.
Sure.
But the one that kills me when they always say, write down, what do you call
references.
That? Okay, here's the thing with the references. Is anybody, because they ask me to put down references for me. Of course they're going to say wonderful things about me.
Right.
I have asked them. They are friends of mine. Or it's a former coworker who thought highly of me.
Right.
No one's going to say, ask that bitch Margaret. It's not going to give you a glowing review. I remember a guy called my buddy back in the day, this guy Jason. He was applying for jobs. He got out of restaurants. He'd been going to school. Now he's getting a job in like the IT world or something.
Yeah.
So they put me down as a reference in the call. I won't say what company it was, but they were so thorough. You know, so I'm like, well, yeah, obviously he's a good guy. And Evan pointed out, he probably wrote me down because we're friends. You have to understand this. But he starts asking me things like, did he have a history of violence? I was like, Jesus Christ, guys. I was like, that's a real question. He's like, yes. I'm like, no.
I've taken calls as a ex-supervisor for my buddies before.
Oh, yeah. I've done that.
Right. I've also taken calls from the CIA because one of my buddies applied. And that was nerve-wracking. That was like, I was on the actual interview. I do not want to mess this up, you know? But I'm still like, has he ever known to do these things or that thing? Like, not that I'm aware of.
Oh, man, he got yayed up on Friday.
But just that one time.
Just that one
time. What do you mean, drugs? Like caffeine? I've seen him smoke a cigarette. That's a drug.
Like caffeine. He's a big coffee drinker, that one.
Sorry, man. He binge studied a lot.
Right. He binge studied. We always wanted to go out and party and just drink and do drugs all the time, but man, he was just hitting the books that one.
Yeah.
Couldn't keep his nose out of it. But the number one shameful life hack that people will admit to but do not regret. Pretending to be a student for discounts.
I've never even thought of that.
Look. I've tried to convince my kids to lie to the ticket agent at the movie theater.
Yes.
And then, of course, kids being kids. Dad said to say I'm 5, but I'm 7. Like, God.
God,
jeez, man. Then you get the dirty look and I'm paying full price.
Right. Mm-hmm. And heaven forbid you answer for them.
No, they will ask the kid directly.
Yeah, it's
like the airport, man. They'll take a look at their passport. All the questions go to them. Right. I told you, my son, last time. There, with the family's there, they ask my daughter in her very quiet voice. She confirms whatever they ask, and then looks at my son and says, "And this is your dad." Points to me. My son goes, "Him?" I was like, "Dude, you're going to get me arrested, man. Come on." I mean, I would do the same thing, and it was kind of funny. It's just in that moment, I'm like, no, this is not the time, dude. This is not the time.
Yes, it is. That's the thing, because you would do it too, and you're right, it's not the time. That's why we're doing it.
That's exactly why you do it.
It may be June, but there's a market town in the UK that still has their Christmas tree up, Miles.
Why would that be?
Tell you all about it at 5:50.
Thank you, sir. Headlines are coming up at 5:50 in the meantime. Let's get a contestant online for Profile. That's at 206-803-ROCK.
Have you or a loved one been injured in an accident? Are you struggling to recover fair compensation? Look no further. At Phillips Law Firm, the experienced personal injury attorneys will fight for your rights and get you the justice and compensation you deserve. They handle a wide range of cases, including car accidents, slip and falls, medical malpractice, and workplace injuries. Justice is a phone call away, so don't wait. Call today for a free case review. Call 1-800-JUSTICE or visit justiceforyou.com.
They called him the most powerful man in Hollywood, and he really was for decades.
He extended his tentacles like an octopus throughout the entire entertainment industry.
Mr. Lou Wasserman.
This is Glitter and Might, an Odyssey Originals documentary podcast series written and narrated by me, Sean Levy. All episodes are available on the Odyssey app or wherever you get your podcasts.
Hey, it's Mike Hawk. Join me every Thursday at 1 p.m. exclusively on the Odyssey app as we go live with Odyssey. Join in on the action as we cover interesting facts, top 10 lists, and some fun new games. Follow the Men's Room page on the Odyssey app and join in all the fun Thursday afternoons at 1.
How do we made it to drinking time?
Somebody out there deserves to be recognized. And the Men's Room knows just who it is. So, to you, we say,
Bottoms up, sailor. You're the toast of our shot of the day.
Big time it is. As usual, we head to the drink desk and Steve will throw hell to find out who we're toasting.
Yes, indeed. And today we toast 76-year-old Bella Montoya of Babahoyo, Ecuador. And I'm pretty sure I said that wrong. Now, sadly, Bella died as a result of cardiorespiratory arrest, which is defined as the cessation of adequate heart function and respiration and results in death without without reversal. So, in other words, if this happens, you ain't giving him CPR. Like, there's nothing you can do. Well, family, they did gather for her funeral, but the vigil ends up getting interrupted, which I generally find to be kind of a very rude thing to do. It's a funeral, but it was interrupted when Bella started knocking from inside of the coffin. Turns out she was not dead, but in an odd choice, the family took her back to the same hospital that had declared her dead in the first place. But apparently, she's in stable condition.
So still alive.
She was still alive, and the tip-off was hearing the... And they opened the coffin, and there she is, like, kind of gasping for air. She's obviously fragile. She's 76, but she was in a freaking coffin, man.
So Jesus.
The looks on everyone's face is kind of a real oopsie-doodle kind of thing. But yeah, they took her back to the same hospital and thought she was dead in the first place. So, good luck. We pour this booze, and we drink this booze because we think it's yummy.
Yummy!
So, over the tongue and down the throat to party in our tummies. Down the hola, bitola!
The Men's Room presents Profile This.
Hey, Stephen Throwhill, could you please tell everyone how Profile This is played?
I sure can, Miles. It's a simple game where we share with you a real-life news story, something that happened right here on planet Earth. And as you listen to the story, based on the stereotypes you believe to be true of people and the decisions that people make, we'll ask you what it is you think makes the story a story. Hello, James. Welcome to the Men's Room.
Hola.
Hola. All right, James, you understand how this year's game is played?
Yes, I do.
Fantastic. You know, then you have your choice of one of five stories. We have The Wonderful World of Drugs. We have Bite Me. In other words, what did someone find in their food? Interior Decorating, where you guess the foreign object that ended up on the inside of someone. Hit Me With Your Best Shot, where you guess the unconventional weapon that someone chose to use as a weapon. And finally, Animalize This, where you guess the animal responsible for causing the problem.
Let's go with Interior Decorating.
Interior Decorating. All right, here is your story. We go to China, where doctors there recently performed an emergency endoscopy to remove something from a woman's intestine after she accidentally swallowed it while trying to dislodge a fish bone from her throat. So the patient reportedly swallowed the object on April 5th, but she didn't bother to go to the hospital until 4 days later because, one, she didn't feel any pain in her stomach, and also she planned on going to some major festival that was happening there. Now, she apparently used the object to remove a fish bone that had become lodged in her throat, but it accidentally slipped from her fingers, and she ended up swallowing it. Now, the woman thought it was too much trouble, like I said, to go to the hospital right before the festival, so she only went to see the doctor after her problem 4 days after the incident. When she finally arrived at the hospital and told doctors what had happened, they ordered an x-ray. They saw the object stuck in her intestine. Luckily, it was removed, and following treatment, the woman was finally discharged and is expected to make a full recovery. The question is, what did this woman accidentally swallow and leave in her intestines for 4 days? Was it a pair of tongs? Was it tweezers? Was it a spoon? Or was it a skewer? So tongs, tweezers, spoon, or skewer?
I immediately thought of one of these objects that you already asked me about for the options when you were saying the story, but I want to know what the experts say.
They're all probable. You know, I think I'm going to go spoon.
You want spoon?
Mm-hmm.
Spoon!
What were they again?
Tongs, tweezers, spoon, or skewer?
Honestly, I think tweezers is speaking to me on this one.
Tweezers?
Yes. All right. James, what are you thinking?
Yeah, I'm thinking about going tweezers. That's the first thing that came to mind.
Okay. Tweezers it is. What did she accidentally swallow? Tongs, tweezers, a spoon, or a skewer? We'll find out next.
That was a tease.
Curiosity surrounds you at Pacific Science Center's Boeing IMAX Theater with state-of-the-art digital projection and sound. Watch your favorite blockbusters on Washington's largest screen. That's 4,800 square feet of the world's greatest heroes and villains coming at you in 2D and 3D. And you're supporting science education in the process. Check out our upcoming schedule and get your tickets before they're gone at PACSci.org. That's PACSci.org.
99.9 KISW. We return to the men's room with Miles and Thrill.
Categories interior decorating on profile. This Chinese doctors removed something from a woman's intestines. She accidentally swallowed while trying to remove a chicken bone from her throat like 4 days before.
Mm-hmm.
So she's trying to get rid of the chicken bone, but she swallowed the object that she's trying to
get
that thing out.
Correct, she got the chicken bone out and swallowed the object.
Question is, was it tongs, tweezers, a spoon, or a skewer?
And James, that is the very question that we posed to you. Now, you and our very own Mike Hawk agreed, tweezers.
Come on,
makes
baby.
The most sense. You even said it was top of your mind when I first brought up the story. However, it was not tweezers. Miles, inexplicably, you picked spoons.
I did spoon.
The worst one,
spoon.
But... Okay! How do you jump on? And they said it's a 13-centimeter spoon. So it's about 4 inches long.
Right. Down she's her digging down in there, and all of a sudden it's gone.
Into her intestine. And she's like, yeah, I'll wait 4 days before I say anything.
Now for all TV news all time, time for TV Time with Tim.
And now, because your pathetic life is confined to countless hours in front of a talking box, the men's room presents TV Time with Ted.
Ah! Everybody have a good weekend. Watch plenty of TV.
A little bit.
You know, just enough. I did, the wife and I got into a new show, got a screaming deal on Peacock. And there was one show that she had to jump onto that she then had to reel me into because that's what happens when you're married. Mm-hmm. It's a show called Vanderpump Rules.
Oh, God.
Yes.
I don't know anything about it other than I'll see, like, headlines from it. But to me, I know as much about that as I know about the Kardashians. You'll see headlines that pop up. I don't, is it?
Like, it's the same thing, dude. Right, it is the same animal. It's just, it's a bar that's called Sur, S-U-R, and I don't even know where in the hell it's at, but it's got a bunch of pretty people in there that are all just banging each other the entire time. And for whatever reason, everybody is offended that everybody else is having sex with the person that they're having sex with, even though they're having sex with everybody
someone else. Right. Okay.
So it's just, I got through like two episodes before I ended up doing something else that was a little bit more fun. She says, do you want to come and watch? I went, really? No.
No.
I mean, I'm sure I can get all roped in on you know,
I
who's
can't
the worst person
like
possible.
Right.
People do watch that show, though.
They do. And you know what? I'm not going to lie. I have gotten sucked into her drama shows, which she admits that they're brain candy. It's just right. Something to let your brain shut mm-hmm. off for a minute while you watch something stupid.
Sure, sure.
But for whatever reason, this one just got to me. It's like, nope, I can't. Can't do it. Last week, I brought you guys a little bit of news that was making me sad in particular because it was sounding an awful lot like one of my favorite actors, Bryan Cranston, was hanging it up.
Correct.
He did mention that he intended on just basically turning his cell phone off, disconnecting from everything, and then going to France with his wife and touring around and whatnot.
Good
right?
for him.
Good news. He's not actually retiring. He's just going to hit the pause button for a year after he turns 70 in 2026.
Right. He's 70.
Fair. He's yeah. 70.
Correct.
He's 70.
I know. He looks good for 70.
That's a good
man.
70, man. Yeah.
He says, quote, I'm not even sure what pausing means entirely, but at this moment, I think it means that by taking a year off, it'll provide several things. He wants to spend more time with his wife, Robin, and have a reset in his career to, quote, replenish my soul and prepare for whatever roles I may be afforded in a more authentic way.
Right.
This will also include a break from social media so that he can read all the books that he's always said that he would. But before that happens, he's got several movies coming out that he's planning to return to Broadway. Brian says, quote, for now, let me just express my deep gratitude to all of you who have been so incredibly kind and generous with your time in reading my posts and following my career. I never take my good fortune for granted. I am blessed, and man, do I know it. I wish all of you well, and we'll see you down the road. So I know exactly what he's doing. He's he just has the ability to do it in a louder way, which is he's turning Facebook off for a while.
Yeah, and you know, it's not when you have his money, you can do that.
Correct.
You know, like, hey, this is my job, this is my career, but I have enough money that I'm just taking a year.
Well, even like a lot of people who are in between jobs, or sure. they're gonna do something else. They'll give themselves a break just to be able to travel
yes.
for a little bit. Look, I just need a reset before I start this new job, so I'm gonna take that month we have and travel around.
I recommend it.
Yeah.
100%. Well, and he's also a hot commodity when it comes to an actor because it's just, when's his last fail? When's the last time that
right.
he did a acting gig, gig that people just absolutely hated. So don't worry. When you come back and say, I'm back and ready to act, you're going to get those phone calls. And
he's in a
stage of his life to where he's not going to be the salty older guy that's able to really kind of be the head of things, but he's going to now be transitioning over to that elder that is just, he knows all that's going. He can probably still be a gangster if he wants to be in whatever the movies
that
he's going to
do. He'll be the older gangster.
Exactly. The one who sits in the chair and just defiantly, you know, craps on the guy that's about to kill him and all that. So good news, Bryan Cranston is not fully, is not retiring there. Just taking a year off, which I can get behind him on that one. We did come to you guys a little while back talking about the big drama surrounding Netflix, that they were going to start cracking down on people's passwords and password sharing and all that, something that they had threatened forever.
Right.
Never actually did until they finally did. And here's the problem. It's working. It says, if you were hoping that Netflix's crackdown on password sharing was going to blow up in their faces, we got some bad news for you. It says, Netflix started enforcing it on May 23rd. So even if you were like me saying, see, they're not even enforcing it. Well, they hadn't quite gotten on it yet. They just did on May 23rd. And over the next 6 days, they averaged 73,000 new signups per day.
Do you know who's not complaining about this?
Who's that?
The people that pay for their Netflix.
Yeah. Yes,
exactly.
It's not the kid. It's the people that are bleaching off of you.
Exactly.
Right. Now, those are the people that are bitching.
Well, right.
Like, look, I pay for my Netflix. I know my daughter's on there. I know there's a couple other people on there. Like, you know, like,
man,
whatever, friends of somebody. But I'm just like, dude, this is mine.
And after reading that, exactly, you're footing the bill for
right, exactly. Like, get your own damn Netflix.
Right. But I had an idea. I was like, so what if we do this, you know, keep the password sharing. We understand that it's just a password. You're going to do what you're going to do. They set the table with it. They created the foundation with this, you know, this is your root home. This is where you're going to be at. And this is the household that's going to be with your main Netflix account. We understand that you're going to share your Netflix password with other people around there. So what we're going to do is we're going to put ads on each and every one of those so that we can still get at least some money's worth.
You know, it's not a bad call.
See?
It's not a bad call. You're right.
We know that you're going to share your password. And look, it ain't costing you a dime, but 3 minutes of your time.
Also, they have a discounted service with ads.
Do they have a discounted service?
You can buy, you can buy a lower tier. You just have to watch ads. So what?
Sure. And I knew that the other streaming services did it. I didn't know that Netflix was on that train where they had a cheaper one that had ads on it, which I don't mind. You know, I feel like the other streaming services that I have, they do have the ads on it. And like I said, it's no big problem. It is a problem at first when you're used to, you know, when you had Netflix before they got that lower tier. And so you didn't have to deal with the ads. You got, you know, maybe you're our premium tier on all these other ones. You remember YouTube when they didn't have all the ads that came in. And so ads seemed like more of an inconvenience because they kind of came into our space versus when I was growing up watching TV.
It was about ads.
The ads were a given. They were always there. And yeah, they at least made the ads fun, and I hope that companies will come back with that a little bit. You know, at this point, that's the reason why everybody's watching the Super Bowl is because the ads are entertaining. They at least for a while there were putting some thought and some writing and some cinematography into what they were actually doing with these ads.
I think the amazing thing is that one of the most boring industries on this planet, which is insurance, right?
Sure,
have some of the best commercials. Progressive, Geico,
Farmers,
right? They're just. Insurance
Allstate
is just not an interesting
Geico.
When you need it, you hope that it works out for you, but it's not something you actually really want to use, right?
Exactly.
But somehow their ads come on, you sit through the whole ad. I've never been swayed to join any of them as a result of it.
Sure.
But anytime an insurance commercial comes on, I watch it, and it's not a problem because it's still entertaining.
Right.
Whether it's Jake from State Farm, the Geico Gecko doing his thing.
J.K. Simmons over there at Farmers.
Right. All of them are good. I'm like, man, this is such a dull-ass industry, but they make their commercials. You can sit through them.
Right. They make entertaining commercials and jingles. You think about all the jingles that you know, a lot of them are doggone insurance companies.
We are Farmers. Bum, 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 bum. Liberty, liberty, liberty.
Continuing on here, 73,000 signups every day, including nearly 100,000 on the 26th and 27th, so just days after they started cracking down on this. It says from May the 25th to the 28th, they had the most signups since early 2019.
Damn.
The spike in May was also bigger than what they saw in March and April of 2020, which is when people were signing up like crazy in the early months of the pandemic lockdowns. And they also saw an increase in cancellations, but the new subscriptions more than made up for that.
Sure.
So everybody was thinking that they were just going to cut their own head off by doing this. You were wrong.
No.
They're doing just fine.
People wanted your password because they wanted to watch something that's on Netflix.
Correct.
So, I mean, their whole theory is like, it's still on Netflix.
You would never give them a password to anything else you have.
Right.
No. Facebook, email.
Yeah, exactly.
You would never just
bank
randomly.
Account.
But here, take this.
Enjoy that.
Oh, by the way, don't use that on three other things.
Right.
Right.
Jeez, a whiz.
But at the end of the day, we need some sort of entertainment. We need something to take us away from the world that we are in right now. We actually do have a study right here, and it shows us the top movies and shows that put you not only in a good mood. It was a study that was done. It says a poll of 2,000 people with streaming subscriptions found that 51% of people claim that what they watch has the power to change their mood for the rest of the day.
Oh, wow.
The rest of the day. And 49% can't watch movies or shows that deal with heavy or stressful topics unless they're, quote, in the right mood.
Correct. I agree with that, man. I mean, it's like, you know, hey, let's have movie night. What do you think? Schindler's List or Full Metal Jacket?
Right.
Like, man, you know what? Maybe we do movie night on another night.
Which makes those movies a shame. Like, one of my favorite movies was Shawshank Redemption, and in the early days of my wife and I's relationship, you know, we're trying to swap movies and get into each other's culture and whatnot, and one of the movies that I really liked was Shawshank Redemption. When do you put that movie on?
Right. It's just, it's not a pick-me-up, man.
You know,
my wife loves the depressing stuff. You know what I mean? But true to its point, you know, she's reduced to sobbing on the couch. Like, babe, you are in tears. You are upset, you know, because you did a buy-in of the characters, which is good.
That's sure. What
you
want.
But, like, you feel heartbroken.
You're
a blubbering mess. Like, why? And you know you're going to be okay. It's not like they surprised you with this crap. So, like, it's just not in my mindset to say, you know what, man? I'm in a pretty good mood. I want to have 2 hours where I feel like crap
just
at the
it
end
all
of
out.
I want just to be depressed when I'm at the, like, and look, there's a lot of very good movies that are that way. I understand it. Full Metal Jacket, like, great movie. Saw it once. I'm like, I don't ever need to see this again.
No. But, yeah, they're not movies that you stumble upon. Yeah. They're movies that it's like, okay, I would encourage everybody to do that at some point. Like, that movie that's in your My Stuff box that you know that you're never just going to feel like grabbing one night. It's like, sure. Set a night. Okay, Friday night I'm going to have some open availability. I got nothing else going on. I'm going to sit down and watch this depressing-ass movie because everybody says it's phenomenal. It's a great
that's
movie.
Like it's that good.
But you're going to feel like crap about yourself
but, you know,
when you watch
but
it.
But at least there's a sales pitch with, like, look, this is a depressing movie, but it's really, really, really well done. I go, okay. Then there's right. movies where it's, I don't know if it's well done or not, but... Like, I bring up Marley and Me.
Right.
Right. I mean, again, I'm not going to watch this movie. I know what happens to
fun
this
fun for about
dog.
An hour and a half.
Yeah, man. Like, right, you're going to get attached to the dog because dogs are dogs and it's going to act like a dog and then the thing's going to die.
Exactly.
I don't want to be a part of that. And sure enough, like I said, she cried when she read the book. Then the movie came out and I'm like, tell me you're not going to this movie.
And like, guys,
I must see it. I'm like, oh my God.
They don't want to be involved in anybody's business.
Yeah.
So many relationship movies.
Or oh, yeah.
Like, stuff like man, it used to be all like, Steve and I could play golf, you know?
Sure.
And come home and be like,
what'd you guys talk about?
How's Steve doing?
I don't know.
He's good, man.
Yeah.
How's things at home? I don't know. You're fine. He's got kids. You know?
How's the kids?
I don't know.
They're in school, I guess, for another week or two.
How's his wife?
He didn't really bring her up. I mean, we were kind of just drinking and playing golf.
Went golfing for 18 holes and you never talked about his
how
wife?
How long were you guys out there?
Exactly. That's why we like spending time together.
You didn't even ask him about, you know, his job, whatever he's doing.
How was our vacation? They just went out.
Where did they go? Oh, it was on Facebook. I have no idea. He didn't even mention it. He looks tan.
Right. Yeah, you're right. It's always this good. Like, I don't know the answers to these questions.
That is not where my mind goes. Is his brother okay?
But that's
What's wrong with his brother? He has a brother.
Is he sick?
Right.
How do you know this?
I guess he's fine. I mean...
But this study did find the happiest shows, the happiest TV shows, the most nostalgic TV shows, stressful and even emotional shows. Your happiest shows that are on television... Whether you're streaming it, they're live or not. The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air comes in at number 3. 59% of people said that that's one of their happy shows.
Okay. I've also heard people say that show transfers well even to your own kids.
Sure.
So that's one that's not really stuck in time to the point where nobody would get it now.
Sure.
61% of people said Friends. Which makes sense. That's just one that stands the test of time. It's a lot of people's nostalgic show. It's just that was their escape show.
I mean, it's not my favorite show, but it's called Friends.
Right. See, and the number 1 happiest show, 65% of people said Modern Family.
Yeah, that show cracks me up. Yeah, cracks me up.
As far as nostalgia, of course, none of these are on the air anymore. You'll see that, I should say, they're not making new episodes anymore. But 36% of people at number 3 said Seinfeld was their most nostalgic show.
Okay.
Do you ever go back and watch Seinfeld again?
I think Curb Your Enthusiasm is a better show to go back and watch.
Okay. Number 2, 37% of people, that's where the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air comes back in. That was just one that was always on when I was a kid.
Yeah.
It was just, it has that 90s vibe.
So it's their happy show and it's their nostalgia.
Correct. And then 38% of people said Friends. That's a comfort show that you can binge watch. It, and it does still hold up. There's other episodes that have come in. And yeah, there's some technological differences that show up there. They're talking about how their rent is so expensive at, you know, $400 a month. You know, that kind of crap. But the most stressful shows. 21% of people said the Netflix show Ozark at number 3.
It is stressful.
It is incredibly stressful, but they're dealing with money laundering. And
so, it's intriguing, but stressful, right?
23% of people at number 2, Grey's Anatomy.
Oh, God. I don't know it that well. But it's a hospital drama, so sure.
Exactly.
People have sex and people die. I mean, that's all I understand about that show. Right. I don't understand stress.
They're either stressing about their relationships or they're stressing about this patient that they just can't. It's like House. They can't figure out why he's dying. But the number one most stressful show, 31% of people said Breaking Bad. Let's go. My wife likes the show, but she doesn't want to watch it because it stresses her out. Said, that's the point of the show.
Right.
He's in a bad situation. The most emotional shows, 28% of people said Sex and the City, 31% of people said This Is Us, and 40% of people said Grey's Anatomy.
Again, drama.
And it's a family drama. My wife loves that show. Yeah. And I'm just like, man, and again, so I walk in halfway through because I'd be doing something else walking. Like, you're already in tears. Babe, why? Why do you watch this show? Mm-hmm. You are never happy when you watch this show.
Oh, baby, I can tell you something happened to Steve. His dog got into some honey and smeared it all over the couch. You told me about that.
That's the kind of conversation we had.
All right.
Goddamn dog.
It was funny.
That's all you talked about?
Is the dog okay?
4.5
Did he take it to the vet? Don't know.
That's all he said.
Few things on for you tonight. Game 5 of the NBA Finals is underway on ABC. Denver leads it 3-1. They're looking to close it out here tonight and become the NBA champions. Stars on Mars is on over at Fox, and then American Ninja Warrior on over at NBC.
Thank you, Mike. We appreciate it. You're listening to The Men's Room.
Hey, guys, remember our first adventure?
That was one amazing trail. And it was awesome that it was nearby.
I felt so energized afterwards.
Dude, you couldn't even keep up.
Rails to Trails Conservancy wants to share the moments you make on the trail at trailmoments.org and on social media at Rails to Trails using hashtag TrailMoments.
Returns with Miles and Thrill. Now, let's see what's happening in the real world.
All right, here we go. Florida man breaks into Busch Gardens in Tampa, Florida to jump into an alligator pit. Meanwhile, telling someone that you went to jail because you shot a mouse. That would be kind of tough to admit. Christmas tree is still up in a town because a pigeon made it their home to Indonesia, where the naked Australian surfer does roam, and a stoned Florida driver busted racing another with his two small kids in the car. It's time for your headlines.
Now, it's time to hit the head lines. Here's Mike Hawk.
All right, top story. We go to the UK, where a small town hasn't been able to catch up with the changing seasons. It may be June, but the town is currently in the news because they've still got their Christmas tree up. This is all because a pigeon took advantage of the free real estate during the Christmas season to jump in and nest inside of the tree. Due to conservation rules and restrictions, the town has been unable to remove the tree until the pigeon leaves of its own volition.
It's a pigeon.
I know.
I'm assuming the tree's dead.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they showed a picture of it. That tree is just absolutely brown. It's honestly a fire hazard at this point.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking. Like, yeah, sorry, pigeon man. Right. You know.
I get that you want to protect the pigeon, but one errant match and this pigeon's going down as opposed to just getting shooed out of a tree, man.
And it's this is not a rare bird.
Right.
It's a pigeon.
Exactly.
Whatever, man.
It's equipped to live outside. It moved into the tree. It can find a new space to move out, you know, move into.
You have other living trees.
Right.
This pigeon can figure it out. I'm sure it can.
Like, yeah, it's going to get set back a few days as it tries to make a new nest, but that's kind of what it does. It didn't have my tree as a nest before.
Right.
So it can just go do it again. We're good to go. Unless there's eggs. I don't know.
Even then, move the nest.
In other news, let's go to the bastion of good decisions known as Florida, where a man showed what it takes to be social media famous. The man was arrested after he hopped a fence into a local theme park, which became the setting for a video that he'd hoped to post on social media. He gallivants about the park while being shouted at by staff to get out and eventually enters into the alligator enclosure. Employees still shout about the dangers of the enclosure that he's in, to which he responds with, quote, another wild Karen. Crikey.
Jesus.
Because he's doggone Steve Irwin. He was eventually caught and arrested by authorities. Nobody was armed in the incident.
You know what? What did he do then? Push his ass into the water.
Right. You know what? He's already...
Here. There you go.
He knows what the dangers are. Okay. Well, let's let nature take its course then. And away we go. To Indianapolis, where a man was just trying to get rid of the mice in his home. Officers got a call about shots fired after the man attempted to kill a trapped mouse in front of the caller and his 8-year-old son. A trapped mouse, by the way. This wasn't a mouse that was just running around.
What?
It was in a glue trap.
Yeah.
Oh, come on. Officers took the man into custody on recklessness charges, and a subsequent search of his home for the firearm turned up a handful of other items in his possession that landed him felony charges. Yay.
What is wrong with you? It's on the glue trap. Like, mission accomplished, brother.
This is an angry individual. That's all I can... You know...
Right.
You know, Miles, picture back to that mouse that you had in the glue trap sitting there, spread eagle. Like, okay, now on top of this, I'm gonna shoot the mouse. Like, yeah.
Right.
No.
I did wonder, what do I do with this thing?
I know.
So I throw in the dumpster.
There you go. let what happens.
Well, I figured that was a home. They like the dumpster.
Yeah, there you go.
Sure. You're gonna go. Might as well go to a place you like.
There you go. A family in California made quite the discovery while renovating the family home. We talked about this a little bit earlier today. The home belonged to one of their fathers-in-law, and were making some updates to the house in order to sell it. Their cleaning took them down to the basement, where they stumbled upon a treasure trove of pennies. It started with a few loose pennies that were eventually progressed into rolls, bags, and even crates of pennies, roughly estimated at over $1 million. They've called a couple of local banks to see if anybody would take them, but they've been running into a few snags along the way. I do feel it necessary to mention, I gave bad advice and was like, you know what, maybe if they're out of date, maybe you might be able to melt them down. No, there was a story released like back in 2006, like, we tweaked the rules. Don't melt your pennies.
Yeah, apparently it's super illegal.
It's super duper illegal. That's a doggone felony, and away you go. That's it for your headlines. With that, Mike Hawk is out.
Thank you, sir. We appreciate it. We'll see you next time. Ryan Castle, be in, and we'll sit and spin the lovely Taryn Daly's up next.
Yes, indeed. It's all true, but in the meantime, we're hell, we be all about this bitch for 180 seconds or so. So until then, please do what you do best. And for Aletha's sake, stay beautiful.
The men's room has been taped before a live studio audience. Wardrobe and makeup provided by Mantastic Limited. This has been a presentation of the Men's Room Radio Network.
Oh, man!
A Double Flush production.